There you go. Walk the moon. Burning down the house. Got that one off the Twitter because we played one of the Ghostbusters theme songs yesterday. E-Rock turned us on to Walk the Moon's version of the Ghostbusters theme, which was okay. And then yesterday someone said, man, if you like Walk the Moon, you got to check out their version of Burning Down the House by the Talking Heads. And that's how it starts today. Good morning, everybody.
Whenever people say, if you like this, you got to try this, I never like this.
You never like
no,
this?
No, it never works out.
I just get it's fascinating to me. I'm like, all right, I'll go with it. I'll try it. We got Sam Morrell in studio, Jim hey. Norton, of course. The British Open is on my TV to my right. I couldn't be happier. It's going to be a good fucking day. I asked Sam Morrell if he watches golf because he's a sports guy. You watch a lot of sports.
Yeah, I try to.
And you said, nah, I think I'll start watching golf maybe in another 10 years.
Yeah, I'm not opposed to it. I think I need time. Like, I like fast-paced sports. I like basketball.
Right.
The only slow sport I like is baseball.
Yeah, eventually, though, when, you know, your metabolism starts slowing down. And
yeah. I respect that you can be that out of shape and be a great athlete. I think that's awesome.
Well,
yeah.
Tiger Woods brought being in shape to golf,
yeah.
Where you actually had to go to the gym and, you know, get your body together. These younger golfers are definitely in better shape than the ones I came up with.
And I like that he was kind of just like, you know, a fucking animal, too. I like every golf player, because of how they dress, you just assume they're a great person. I like that.
Tiger was just
banging.
An animal.
Yeah, I like that he was fucking through everything, you know. And not that I even saw him as a villain, but I like a villain in sports.
Yeah.
You know, I like a guy that, like, everyone else is rooting against, you know?
Who's your villains in sports, you think? Give me a few.
OJ.
I mean, Kobe was a villain.
Sure.
I like that he was, I'm not even talking about just even the sexual allegations. I'm talking about he was just an asshole. I like
right.
assholes.
Right. Some people would just call that confidence.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of other villains in sports.
Barry Bonds.
Barry Bonds was a villain. That's
a
good one.
Yeah, Bonds made it like, he made it fun, you know? Like, when he'd get up to the plate and you know, you knew he was a dick to everyone in the locker room, but then he was up there and, like, you're about to see someone in a kayak chase a baseball. It was fucking awesome.
Right, know? Right. What about A-Rod?
Love A-Rod.
Villain?
Absolutely. I mean, he looked like... I mean, A-Rod is the ultimate villain. The way he, like, just with a, like, you know, I knew someone who worked for the Yankees. They're like, A-Rod was so desperate to be liked that he would just, like, send muffin baskets around Yankee Stadium.
Oh, you
know?
God.
He needed friends, you know?
Who would he send muffin? I would love to get a muffin basket from A-Rod. What a fun gift.
And
what
kind of muffins? Hopefully blueberry.
Yeah, he went one for eight in the series, but he sent me a muffin basket. All right.
When he appealed that suspension, that was hilarious.
Yeah. Like, I just assumed he didn't want to be liked.
No, I think...
Because that makes it even worse.
He was in Jeter's shadow, so I think he felt it. Like, he probably didn't feel it until he came to New York.
But he felt like the muffins would put him over the top.
Yeah.
Yeah, muffin basket will really right a lot of wrongs.
It's hard to hate someone after they give you a muffin.
I'm
not going to lie to you.
Yeah.
You're ready to yell and scream at someone, and they hand you a muffin?
I helped cover up for a Subway slasher once. He handed me a muffin. I told the cops I didn't see anything.
What about Tom Brady? Villain.
I respect him.
I don't think he's a villain either.
You don't think he's a villain?
No, he's just good. People don't like him because he's good. But
he's
not like
handsome.
Huh?
He's handsome and he's fucking a supermodel.
Yeah,
and
but
he's the best.
He's not a villain.
Do you have to hate your teammates to be a villain?
Hate your teammates?
Because I don't think he hates his teammates.
Hated throughout the league. No, your teammates probably.
But he's hated throughout the league, especially with the Deflategate, which is all bullshit.
But football is different. Like baseball, you can be an individual piece of shit and not really, I think, divide the team because you're just up there alone.
Right.
You know, but in football, if you're a quarterback, you've got to be somewhat liked.
So there's no villains in football?
There are, but they're usually wife beaters or something, you know? Like Greg Hardy's he's a villain. You know?
He's a villain. Yeah, he's an asshole, actually.
Yeah.
Brady's got to sit out those four games.
Good.
I think it's going to help the Patriots. If they can hang in there and win a few of those games when he's out, then he's not going to be beat up when the playoffs come rolling around. I think it could work out, work in their favor.
But they'll be fine. They're always in the mix.
But I don't think they're going to... I think they want to try to, you know, send this right to the Supreme Court. No?
Why doesn't Brady just stop it? You get caught. It happens. It's stupid. But, you know, it's one of those dumb things. Look, Nixon shouldn't have got caught with Watergate. It, these dumb things happen. Let it just fucking take your suspension and shut up.
Just let it be. I think it frustrates him because he knows every single team does a little cheating.
Yeah, yeah. When they testify for Congress, like with the steroids, I'm like, get a fucking real thing to do. It's pathetic.
Right.
Remember when Hurricane Katrina happened and they were like spending more days on the steroid issue than Katrina? I mean, it's fucking pathetic because they're little fanboys.
Right.
Because they love baseball.
I don't want the courts tied up with this shit.
No, I don't, and I just don't give a fuck if they're doing steroids.
Yeah.
Makes the game that much better. I don't know these people personally.
Yeah, that's like...
I'm not going to be bothered when their bodies start fucking giving out on them because they did steroids during their careers. I'm not going to have to be at that picnic or family event.
Yeah.
So I don't give a fuck. And I can explain that to my kids.
Yeah.
No problem. Yeah, these guys are animals. They want to hit 600-foot home runs, so they pop their hineys with some needles. I'll tell them.
Sports Center was so much better when people were on steroids. When they were just, like, destroying the ball.
It was great. Who doesn't like that? Even baseball liked that. That's why they looked the other way for so many
years. Oh, I like bunting on Sports Center. There's nothing I like more than a single up the middle that gets hustled out.
Would you like a whole half-hour show on bunting?
Yes, I
certainly
would.
The greatest bunts of all time?
The greatest bunts, but it's only kind of half fat women.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. So, all right, well, we got the British Open for me, then. I'm going to take a peek as we're doing the radio today. Rory McIlroy's in the lead. It's one of the majors, so. Yes, Jimmy?
The only time they shouldn't use performance-enhancing drugs is, like, for fighting sports, because if one's taken and one's not, you're going to really hurt somebody. But baseball, it's like, who gives a fuck?
Right.
Football, I don't know, because there's so much contact.
That sport's just getting so fucking brutal and violent.
Yeah, it's like the gun issue. Like, it's a problem.
Don't mention guns!
Yeah. We just don't know how to deal with it.
Right.
I mean, football... We know it's bad. We know it's killing people. Who's that guy, Junior Seau, when you're like...
Shot himself in the chest.
He died.
Yeah.
Yeah, he did.
He passed.
You know it's an issue, but if I have a kid, I don't want him to play football, but...
No.
Am I going to watch it? Fuck yeah.
If I have a kid that's big, I want him to play football. If I have a sleight of frame kid, I don't want him to play football. But if my wife's pussy is ruined by some fucking 6'4 mongoloid, fucking go out there and tackle everything, you dope.
But the thing with football, everyone knows how violent it's getting, but they'll line up to play. They don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
There's a million guys that will go, look, you don't want to do this? I'll step right in and I'll do this. No problem.
Yeah, but people are just dropping dead. You know, like, that's not happening like tennis. You know, it's
unfortunately,
clearly...
what you should say.
Oh, tennis is a sport I never got into watching.
Oh, really?
I'll watch Wimbledon a little bit, and then I go, all right, whatever. I hate tennis. That's one sport I can honestly say I never got into. Except for what's-his-name when he was yelling and screaming. That made it fun. McEnroe. Oh.
Yeah,
but that's way before your fucking time. But when he was yelling and screaming at the umps and everybody else, it was great.
Throwing his rackets. Yeah, people kind of hated him, but at least he woke you up.
Yeah, of course.
He was fired up.
He was fired up. Got Theo Von in studio, too. Wanted to take advantage of the fact you're on the East Coast before you head out of here, and we don't see you for a while. So what's up, buddy?
Appreciate it, man. Not much, man. I used to actually do steroids when I was younger.
Really?
Yeah. Used to shoot them up.
For what reason?
Just me and this gay gentleman actually used to do them on the side of the interstate when I was growing up.
It's weird.
And,
why would you do it with a gay guy?
He just happened to be gay.
Right. And he was just a friend of yours.
That's cool. It's a good guy to share needles with.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I think I'll be all right. I hope.
Was it for sports reasons or you just wanted to get big?
Just to fit into a shirt a little bit better.
Did it work?
Yeah, man.
Did you really notice, like they say?
Yeah, I felt like a champion, dude. I felt like I wanted to just grab people and, like, set them somewhere else, you know?
You did. You felt... How long into it did you start to feel?
Maybe 2 weeks.
And then when you come off it, they were just cycling through it. Like, how'd you come off it?
I didn't really have a plan. I just ran out.
Oh, you just ran out of money and steroids.
Yeah, and that was it. And then you, like...
What happens to your body at that point?
You start losing weight, and it's kind of alarming because you don't know what to tell, like, your friends and stuff. You're like, ugh, you know? I bought all these big shirts.
How much weight did you gain from steroids?
Maybe about 15 pounds.
But it was all muscle, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and then you can't do the same weight anymore, so you're like kind of alarmed. You're like, I don't know, you're bummed out. You're constantly trying to do the same weight, and you can't do it anymore.
Oh, you put weight on too, right? It's not just, is it muscle? Like, do you get fat after you come off them?
Your face gets a little puffy. Your neck gets kind of big. I got some cheap ones too, I think. I mean, this half of this stuff could have been homemade. You know, it could have been pretty bootleg.
That's pretty scary.
Yeah, it was pretty scary. Yeah, I wouldn't do it again.
You injected in your ass?
Yeah, we did it alongside the interstate, actually. And
why
I don't know.
The interstate? That's where you guys just hung out?
Yeah, it's where we did it. We
just relax, enjoy the breeze of the other vehicles.
That's where we would go do it, man.
The warm exhaust.
I don't know if it's a sin or not. I know it's not appropriate roadside behavior, though. I know that.
No, it's not.
You know?
It's not the best environment to shoot stuff into your body in.
Yeah, we could have done something better.
One of our guys does a lot of steroids, Paul, and he has he's got something on this. Yes,
well, when
Paul.
You take it.
You really do them?
I've done them before.
For what?
I was just joking. Jesus.
No, I did them in high school.
For what reason?
Not pure steroids, but pro hormones.
Right.
And your sinuses?
No.
Why hormones?
Because it puts weight on and gains muscle mass.
Ooh.
When you take them, you're supposed to take like fish oil to protect the heart and milk thistle to protect the liver. And then after, you're supposed to take a post cycle. So your hormone level goes up. If you don't take the post cycle, it drops dramatically because it's looking for more. The post cycle is supposed to like decrease it slightly so you don't lose it all at once. And that's, people don't take post cycles. So you have that big loss right after you take a cycle.
Oh, okay. And when the loss happens, what happens to you?
Well, you lose muscle mass and you get weaker.
What happens to your penis? That's all I want to know.
Yeah.
Yeah, what happens to your penis on steroids?
It probably looks bigger by comparison because your balls shrink, right?
I think it felt okay most of the time. I did notice that some, like, your spray would gum up a little, you know?
It would get gummy.
Yeah.
I don't mind a good gum up load.
Ugh, yeah,
really?
Fucking yeah.
It was aggressive.
She stands up and still hanging off her cheek, like a hornet nest sloth.
Yeah. Oh god, yuck! All right, but you didn't do it for sports. You just did it to look good and be able to pump a little extra weight in the gym.
Yeah, just self worth, I think. You know, just like stacking it on. And
you're tired of people kicking sand in your face like that. I'm in the back of the comic books, Get Big. They would show the guy getting sand kicked in his face.
Sure.
Mac the bully.
Absolutely.
I was losing handshakes, man. I got tired of that. So I was ready to kind of beef up, I think.
Would you do it again? Yeah.
I wouldn't do it again. I did it a couple times and I wouldn't do it again.
Why? It scared you a little bit?
Yeah, I started to get scared because you can tell that people know after a while. I almost got in a fight a couple times and I wouldn't ever do that.
So you felt like
you got keyed up. Yeah, your brain would be like,
all
you
right,
know.
So you did feel that. I was going to
let's eat.
That roid rage.
Yeah, roid rage, right.
Let's eat. Let's drive fast.
What about the pimples?
You got some stuff on your neck and back, but they were kind of cool. They were like, they were ready to lift weights too, they looked like. That is it. They could do curls, kind of like that.
Very nice.
We had this kid in high school who was doing them, and he had pimples all over his face, and we would squat the pressure. He'd pop all the pimples on his face, and his face would be like bleeding while he would be squatting.
Just from the squat exercise?
Yeah, all the pressure.
Oh, wow.
It's cool. What year was he when he died of a heart attack?
He made it to 22.
Jesus Christ. His face must be a disaster now.
It was. I don't know how it is now.
Wow, I never heard of that one before.
They can do more with acne now, right? Like, I remember there was one kid who had tortured, you know, like, he just had...
The worst.
Yeah, it's like the type of acne where it's just like, forehead, nose, every...
I was lucky. I had it at 17, 18, like anyone else, and that was it. Never had to deal with it again.
Yeah.
Some people, they got to deal with it their whole lives.
But adult acne is heavy. Adult asthma is pretty heavy, too, I think.
You think? Of course, yeah.
What's that lady got on her face?
Oh, my God.
All the way to the right.
What is this? There's bad acne related to steroids?
Is that acne?
Oh, my God.
That looks like it was a Photoshop.
That looks like a Photoshop.
Yeah, that doesn't look real. Oh, all right, anyway.
Looks chocolate chip.
Yeah, what's that? She wouldn't be smiling. Yeah, those other ones are deep, though.
Right. I just got to acknowledge that yesterday was a crazy show. We had Caitlin Farrington in here, very hungover and still probably drunk. And then she just started puking off and on throughout the whole morning.
Wow.
While we're doing a radio show.
Who is it?
Puked in front of Paul Feig, the director of the Ghostbusters. She won a gold medal at the Winter Olympics, so she came through doing some promotion about 2 years ago, right? It's about 2 years now. More, I guess. and showed off her gold medal, and we hit it off. So when she comes to town, she comes by and says hi. And she was a mess.
She's cute.
Yeah, she was a mess yesterday morning.
I like Caitlin. She's an interesting guest. She's always fun to talk to.
Yeah, and then she just started puking all over the... We got a video that's doing really well. We don't even have to promote it. People are loving the puking video, especially when she's puked in front of Paul Feig, the director of Ghostbusters. The funny thing is, Paul walks in. She needs to get out of the studio immediately because she's ready to puke. And I'm trying to be a nice guy, and I introduce her to Paul Feig. Oh. So now she feels like she doesn't want to be rude, so she's shaking his hand and saying hi to the guy. Then she goes out. Then Mark Norman was the guy that said, I think she went, she's leaving the studio to go puke, and Mark was right. And then she started power booting in the studio. She puked on my oatmeal, my breakfast.
I was trying to get her to puke by talking about fingers down the throat.
Oh, you nailed it.
And I was my hiney scratch is a big hit.
When that was pointed out, it made me very happy once again all day long.
But let me point out what that was. I wasn't digging in my asshole. You could see my hand goes in. It was a really weird scratch.
Yeah.
My hand went in with my palms facing out, and it came back up the same way. You'll see it.
And the camera zoomed out perfectly.
Here we go. Here's Jimmy. See, it's palms out. Palms out.
Oh, that's safe.
Boom. Watch back. Palms still up. It was a half a second scratch on the top of the cheek.
Like the German coach.
Yeah, we were hoping.
I didn't smell it, though. I probably should have.
We were hoping you were going to go for the smell.
No.
But how great is that? You got a gold medal winner, bent all the way over, power booting, and then Jimmy is touching his hiney crack.
Yeah, I got an itch.
He had a little itch in the back there.
That's how used to vomiting I am in the studio. It's like somebody's puking. It's like, well, just business as usual.
Yeah, but that was just...
Ooh, wow, it's kind of sexy a little bit.
It is, right?
Yeah.
She's ripped, too. She's in good shape.
Yeah.
Well, she's good at it.
But she's a good egg, and I hear she's doing much better today. I don't...
Really?
She doesn't give a fuck, though.
That's how hangovers work.
Yeah, I had same here, man. I had a long night. It was pretty gnarly.
What, last night?
Yeah, pretty gnarly.
You don't look like you had a bad night.
I don't?
No. You look fine. Where were you?
Oh, I got a haircut yesterday from this gentleman. He's Colombian, actually.
Oh, good.
I thought you cut your own hair.
Yeah, well, I changed it up now. I've been inspired.
Oh, after our talk the other day?
Yeah, and I saw those bangs. I was like, I don't want to live like this anymore.
So where'd you find the hair cutter?
Just looked them up on my phone. Just put salon in there.
Right.
First people that came up.
Oh, the website.
Yeah, went upstairs. It was this Colombian guy. He seemed, one of his eyes was a little, something a little defunct, but the other one was solid, and he did it. He did a good job.
Yeah. You guys do some crazy shit in the interstate?
No, nothing like that. No steroids, just hair.
All right.
Wait, so you just got a random place? Was it a legit place, or was he trying his own shit out in his apartment?
Yeah. It didn't seem 100% legit. A lot of the equipment seemed old, you know?
Right.
But he washed my hair, and he played some pretty cool music, kind of like maybe dance music, like reggae, but from another country that's not Africa.
Where?
Midtown.
Pull the mic up just a bit.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, somewhere in Midtown.
Oh, Midtown, okay.
Yeah.
Sounds pretty good. Sounds slightly homoerotic.
Yeah.
He said he was married.
Going into the, pretty much, it sounds like you were going into someone's apartment to get a haircut.
Yeah. You know, hang your head off the bed.
Yeah. That'd be tough.
You just like adventure, huh?
Sometimes, man.
You like adventure and new experiences.
Yeah.
You like to go a little off-roading, as we like to say.
Yeah, I've made some more choices.
There's a million places you could have got your haircut legit in Midtown Manhattan.
Yeah.
That just bores you, probably.
Yeah, I mean, this was an adventure. I mean, this guy was definitely, when I saw that only one good eye, I was like, this is going to be wild, you know? But I feel like the other one came in pretty strong.
I don't know if I want a guy with one eye cutting my hair.
Yeah.
I don't know if that would work out, right? But you got a wonderful haircut.
Oh, my God. Right?
Good for you.
It's a home run. Look at
that. It's wonderful, Theo. It worked out for you. And then what did that lead to? You said you had a rough night.
I went out with...
you do some stand-up?
I did Mo... I did Mo Mandela's a new show. You did it, right? Comedy Knockout?
Yes. My friend works at True TV, and I like Damien very much.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Who'd you do it with?
I did it with Sarah Tiana and Monroe Martin.
Oh, I like Monroe Martin, yeah.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah.
So it was pretty cool. We had a good time, and then I went out... A buddy of mine had a fashion show. I went to the fashion show, New York Fashion Week.
Oh, it's Fashion Week?
Yeah.
Already?
It's Men's Fashion Week.
That's a long shoot, by the way. That takes a while. Have you done Comedy Knockout? It's a fun show, but it takes a while to shoot.
Yeah.
That's not like a 30-minute shoot.
No, it was slow. It took a long time. I lost, too.
And you get there, and you got, like, you know, a bunch of stuff to go over.
Yeah.
It was just a long evening.
Yeah.
but well done.
It was good, man. And then we went out, and then we just stayed out.
You look fine, Jesus.
Thanks, man.
What time
do
you get home?
I'd say probably about 4:30.
Oh, wow. Okay.
That's only a couple hours ago.
Yeah.
What's your drink of choice?
It was tequila.
Holy fuck.
And water.
The water's key, right?
I think so. I don't know. The tequila felt pretty key at certain points. And it was like a lot of like hipster kids and stuff like dancing really well. I felt pretty uncomfortable.
Why?
But I bared with it. I'm just not good at that. Like when people raise their hands up in the air and are having a party.
It's embarrassing. I find it embarrassing.
I don't like dancing with drinking. I like to just chill at a bar.
Yeah.
Dancing. Like, why are you fucking? We're men. Why are you dancing?
I don't like dancing.
Yeah. I hate it.
I mean, you know, at a wedding, you get pulled up there. You go, all right, I'll fucking squeeze out a song or two. And now I'm sitting right the fuck back down. Right?
Yeah, you hold your beer with one hand. At a party, like, you want to hold your beer with one hand and you pop lock with the other. That's what I do.
That's your go-to move?
Sure is.
It sure is.
I get very embarrassed dancing. I admire people who can do it, like, be comfortable with it. Like, I can't. It looks fun if you like it.
Right.
Like, that's got to be fun when there's music playing just to be fucking all over the place. But I just stand like a fucking frightened, nervous, self-centered rabbit. Don't look at me.
I think women don't really want a guy that could dance well, right?
Unless it's like Latin America.
I think they test all of us. Like, yeah. And they're relieved when you can't dance. Like, oh, God, thank God. Thank God he can't dance well. No? I've never experienced a woman that gets excited because a guy could dance well.
Maybe if it's like a friend, but if it's... If
no,
it's
someone like, they're into. Yeah. You know what I mean? I've never seen that before.
I mix flash dance with MC Hammer shit. At the office. I mixed flash dance with MC Hammer shit.
good old Ricky Gervais.
The fucking worst face after he says it.
Right. He's beautiful.
Yes.
With MC Hammer shit.
White people always look like they learn the dance online, you know?
I don't even know. It's not worth learning. Right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. The Pokemon Go is getting even crazier as the days go on.
I finally saw someone playing it last night, coming back. I could see her phone, she was playing it.
Well, it's enraging, right?
No, I sidekicked her in front of the cab.
It's now we got people that are playing Pokemon Go while they're driving.
Yeah, that's bad, I think.
Oh, Eric's got a mic. Yes, Eric.
Eric. Friend of mine, Brian, lives out in Minnesota.
Lie!
Shut up.
Just say Brian.
In Minnesota. He said about 11:30 last night on his Snapchat, and he was showing a video. There was a park near him that was filled with people still doing the Pokemon thing, and they had been there for at least 5-6 hours.
It's like, this might be, is there any been an experience where you're in the video? This is almost like being in a video game in a way, where you can walk around and you're alive with it. Maybe that's what's so crazy about it. It's like Atari.
Yeah.
For your, that's the first experience of being in a video game.
I mean, I have it on my phone. I've fooled around with it a little bit, but I'm already seeing where I'm not gonna get too involved with this thing.
Yeah.
But it was fun at first.
I wonder if it's a good way to like meet people because you're getting outside. Like if you're like real techie, you're not inside anymore.
Oh my God, of course it's a good way to meet people. You can see all the people playing. And you almost now.
How do you see them playing?
It's how they hold their phone.
You don't mean on the phone, you mean walking around.
Oh no, you don't even have to see what's on their phone. Like when you're texting, you're straight down. But if you're playing Pokemon Go, it's more up on an angle like this. You could totally tell. And people are sort of, New Yorkers are sort of like interacting a little bit. You notice more eye contact because you're like, oh, you're playing too. And it's like almost like a smile and a nod like, yeah, you're into this shit too.
What is
absolutely
the premise?
Travis, help me out. I don't know. You're collecting Pokemon. There's gyms where you can battle other people. Then you got to get Pokeballs so you can take out the Pokemon. Pokemon.
There's already a cheat online, so you don't have to go outside.
Yeah, people are figuring out if you put it on a turntable or your ceiling fan,
right?
It counts as whatever the traveling thing.
Who figured that out? A guy named Bubba?
Yeah.
Eric? Oh. You put it on the like a turntable or the ceiling fan stuff and just let it go for a while.
Right.
It does all the travel requirements, and then it opens up all, and unlocks everything that you get.
Do you really do that, though?
I haven't played it. Oh, I'm just saying, I saw the video come out yesterday, and then everyone was going crazy, like, hey, we don't have to go outside anymore. They put it on treadmills, they put it on
but
anything.
You still have to go out because it's GPS-based.
It's dudes playing it. I see a lot of dudes.
It is GPS-based, but...
I get what Eric's saying. Like, there are some instances where, like, that would work for... Like, I don't mean to get too technical, but sometimes there's eggs and you have to incubate the eggs and you have to incubate them by walking. So if you put it on a turntable, I'm sure it would count that you're making steps around the house. And then your egg would be incubated and you get a Pokemon.
You think that, does the game wonder why you're just like an autistic walking in a circle, really a tight circle?
Right. The game does not discriminate.
It's not discriminating. But leave it up to humans. They finally, you know, have this app where you have to go outside. So a lot more people are walking around that haven't walked this much in years. And then someone figured out, fuck that. We can still do this inside.
If you have a turntable and you play Pokemon, you're so not my type of person, though.
Yeah, but turntable.
Oh, yeah, you're
but turntables coming back there, Sam.
Are they?
Yes.
I'm caught fly for this. I've never gotten DJing, man. I never understood it as like when people were like, trying to defend it as like an art form. I'm like, shut up, you fucking, you it's a glorified mixtape,
right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, there's videos online where it proves that these guys aren't even doing anything up there. They just have to look good.
They've got their MacBook Pro up there.
Yeah, they put all their
Paris Hilton's a DJ.
Yeah, they put,
yeah, she's right, good though.
They put their whole I guess, do we just call it a playlist? They want to or their show together, and then they sit up there and make them believe they're doing it all live.
Yeah, that's what Dennis does.
Her song was good though. That was that one song.
Oh god,
stars
or something.
Oh my god, that was a great tune.
Stars are blind.
Oh,
stars are blind.
She's
right?
She's a songbird.
Yes.
Wonderful voice, like an angel.
Do you want some of these Pokemon news stories? They're pretty good. There's a car crash. There's a stabbing. There's a lady stuck in the graveyard.
I like this game.
Yeah. Which one is the best one out of the three, you think?
There's a couple more after that,
too. Car crash
there's
is pretty
a few
good.
More this morning.
Wait, if you crash your car because you're fucking looking for a Pokemon,
yeah, you lose.
You're awesome. That should win you the game. That's next. I'll tell you what's next is virtual reality things over your face where there's no phone and you're just living in it. That's mm-hmm. going to be great. That I'll play.
Yeah.
You wait 2 or 3 years until that comes out, bunch of assholes with goggles, and then they'll get like Google Glass where they're smaller and smaller, and then I'll fucking play.
Oh, my, he really destroyed it.
Yeah, it'd be like crazy
car accident from
oh my god!
God, it looks like
what did he hit?
He looks probably like a divider.
Fucking the Intrepid.
Jesus.
How's the story go, Iraq?
Apparently,
I think I got it in front
intense,
of me too.
Man.
Right?
Hit a tree and dead center of the car, and you can see the whole front is sort of just
is he alive?
Parted in half.
I got the story.
Oh, that's it.
Trees just don't get out of the
he
fucking
suffered
way.
Suffered broken ankles and cuts to his legs.
Oof! Imagine two broken ankles.
Yeah,
how much that would suck.
Yeah.
That would not be good.
Did he tell them he was Pokemoning, or did he fucking...
Well, it says...
How'd you confess that?
It says an upstate New York Poke fanatic was playing the wildly popular game in Auburn on Tuesday night when he veered off the road and crashed into a tree. My God. There were no serious injuries in the clumsy crash, which damaged the front... All right, we know all that. They fucked up his car pretty good, actually. Driver told officials, I was just trying to find Jimmy's answer here. Driver
Why
told,
would the driver say that?
Driver told officials he was distracted by the game when he plowed into the tree. God, it's bad enough with these people driving and texting. Now I got to deal with them playing Pokemon on the fucking Long Island Expressway.
Yeah, that's what happened to Harry Chapin. Playing Pokemon, 1981.
He was way ahead of the curve.
As he was.
A 15-year-old Pennsylvania girl was hit by a car while crossing a busy intersection on Tuesday at about 5 p.m., her mother told reporters.
Wow.
Kids don't just cross highways, her mother told the news. This thing had her walking across a highway to find a Pokemon.
Wow.
That's just stupid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't feel bad for that person.
No, they should only put Pokemons in places that can get people killed.
Oh,
that's an awesome game.
Now we're talking.
Can you imagine having to address that at a funeral? You know, just like, it was like, yeah, she fucking really liked the game.
She died doing what she loved.
Yeah.
Going foot with her thumb.
Yeah, what would you even say, man? I don't know.
I don't want to go like that. So when she called and said that she was hit by a car, I blamed the game because she would not have been out of my house. My daughter is a hermit.
Oh, wow. Well, it is getting... Oh, these socially inept people who've been home playing video games and me online all their lives are now seeing the sun for the first time and they don't know how to handle it.
Hey, look how pale she is.
Yeah, they don't know that the cars are actually moving.
No.
Yeah.
Is this the news story?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Let's...
No.
I just love listening to the local news and how they handle these dumb stories.
Yeah.
We're just waiting through a commercial. Go. All right. This is the one that crashed his car.
No, this is the teen crossing.
Oh, this is the teen
crossing? Okay. There's no news story with
the car. All right, we're just waiting for the commercial.
You said
bear with us.
Is it an interstate? Wow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. She was, it wasn't just a, it was a highway or an interstate or something. All right, here we go. Finally. Finally.
Pokemon on Go Craze has taken America by storm. You see players wandering around staring at their phones trying to catch invisible creatures. But the game took an unexpected turn last night for a local girl. She claims the game led her right into the path of danger. Brenda Waters joins us live now with more on what happened. Brenda.
Hi, Ken. The Pokemon app, here it is, just debuted last week. And when you open it, it comes with a warning. It tells you to always be alert and to be aware of your surroundings. 15-year-old Autumn Dizeroff
sounded hotter. I thought.
What's your name, Dizeroff? Not perfect.
Crossing this four-lane highway,
four-lane highway,
the Torrington Bridge in the heat of rush hour traffic, around 5 p.m. when she was hit by a motorist.
The game dragged her across that highway.
That game is the Pokemon app. The point is to find.
It didn't
Pokemon.
Drag her across the highway. No, someone tell Ben Franklin her daughter just fucking walked down.
Yep. Autumn found her Pokemon a block away from her house. Here at the Heritage Museum.
She found her Pokemon, was all excited, was coming home to tell mom she found her Pokemon.
Yeah.
Folks, she was not.
Can you say Pokemon?
She was crossing the highway. She was crossing
her
the
mom's
highway.
Her mom's D. Snyder. She was
not.
The car
came from.
So.
And I was in the middle of it, but I tried to get out of the way so I didn't get hit fully.
Right. She got clipped. Mm-hmm.
So it could have been a lot worse.
Yes, it could have been.
I'm not blaming the game itself. I'm saying I'm blaming the game itself because it's dragging kids across highways.
Oh, that happened.
Major highways. Kids don't need to be going across highways.
Well, so how about you teach her that lesson, you know, 5 years ago?
Yeah, it's kind of a parental thing.
Yeah, this is a parental thing, absolutely.
I'm guessing that kid is homeschooled.
It looks like acne. It doesn't even look that bad, I don't feel like.
Yeah, she took one.
Continue. The computer's just fucking up. Is it gonna?
Why is no one asked to have these replaced?
I don't know.
I don't know.
The internet connection. It's not.
Is it? Why everyone needs to watch this particular story?
Everyone's on Wi-Fi playing Pokemon.
I wonder if it's crashing some sites. You know, people are just poking out.
We got the
gist of the story.
Yeah, you don't need.
I just wanted to hear the moms say Pokemon again. Pokemon. And all right, whatever. So, and then we got a sex offender, Indiana sex offender arrested while playing Pokemon Go with teenage boy on courthouse lawn. What's this one about? Is this a news story or a video or no?
I don't think so. I saw it this morning. So it's
all right. A registered sex offender in Indiana is behind bars after he was nabbed allegedly playing Pokemon Go with a teenage boy. Randy Zook of Greenfield was on the county courthouse lawn brazenly catching Pokemon with a 16-year-old boy when two probation officers spotted him in action. Oh, I guess I was thinking he might have been doing something with the actual teenager. After spying the Pokemon playing perv, one officer ran inside and asked the security officer to take Zook into custody. Last October, Zook was accused of fondling a child his girlfriend was babysitting. He pleaded guilty in April to a felony charge of child molestation. Since then, he's been on probation and banned from interacting with kids.
Yeah, what kind of trouble she get in for being a blabbermouth?
These pedophiles, man, they're out there.
Yeah.
And they're getting...
Pokemon's a good game.
They're aggressive.
Yeah, there's one in here.
I'm not it.
You don't know Uncle Paul?
Oh, nuh-uh.
Meet Uncle Paul Theo.
You're not missing anything.
I was never molested though, so
that you know of.
Yeah,
maybe you're you know.
I remember falling asleep at this man's house one time.
Oh boy!
And he was a substitute teacher, but he ended up getting busted for being a pedophile. And he bought a kid some speakers, and that's when they busted him. This guy, Big Richard, this white guy.
Why were you over his house?
I was over there smoking weed. He used to buy us pot. We'd hang out over there.
Well, that was to get you guys in his house, and then he was like testing you out.
Yeah, yeah,
seeing which ones were the vulnerable ones.
Yeah, we busted him one time. Oh, he said I was getting my buddy was having a we were having steaks. He bought us steaks with baked potatoes, and my buddy yelled from the living room. He's like, "Hey, can you give me some sour cream?" And I yelled back, "No, you can have some of this sweet cream." You know, joking about pretty much semen.
Yeah,
and then Richard said, "Can I have some?" And that's when we knew.
Well, you got to share, Theo.
That's when we knew, man. So
selfish boy.
But yeah, this is really a field day for these pedophiles because all these kids are coming out in the parks and everything.
Yeah.
Well, so a lot of shit's going on. I said it the other day. I think there's going to be some lawsuits. Somebody's going to sue Nintendo.
Probably, yeah.
Maybe they won't have a good case, but I feel like...
No, nobody's forcing anyone to go anywhere.
No, I understand that, but but we know how our society is.
Yeah,
someone's
going to
come up with some kind of lawsuit. Yeah, that mother would probably like to sue Nintendo, even though she's the responsible one. She should teach her daughter you don't cross four-lane highways.
Well, she was saying the word drags these kids. It drags these kids.
Drags, right.
And plus, even if you win the lawsuit, you got to defend it.
Right.
You know?
Didn't this girl, they just said this guy had a girlfriend, and she was babysitting the kid, and he tried to hook up with the kid?
Yeah, yeah. I don't think you call it hooking up.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about cool pedophiles. You know? Right, right. So, yeah, I was banging this kid, you know? But, that's kind of weird that she would, you know, she should probably not date a registered sex offender.
Yeah, she should know that.
That's something you should probably know.
I think you're 100% right on that. We have one more Pokemon story about a girl freaking out in a graveyard there. E-Rock.
Yeah, she was searching for Pokemon and got stuck in a graveyard. They shut the gates and she couldn't get out of the graveyard.
Oh, all right. Yeah, that would suck.
Okay.
Yeah. All
right. Why was she playing at a graveyard?
She's probably where the Pokemon were.
Yeah.
Well, you got to go get your little guys.
Yeah, they're everywhere there. They're in some dangerous areas. Which some opportunists have realized. So you got some bad people waiting for you to innocently enter their area because you're looking for a Pokemon, and now they're holding you up. Those stories came out earlier this week.
Yeah, if your Pokemon has a fucking sideways baseball hat on it, don't go in the neighborhood.
All right, push play on this one, please. Stuck in a graveyard.
I came to the graveyard to catch some Pokemon, you know? And go to the gym, right? Well, you know, I'm in the graveyard. Let's see, the gate was open because, you know, I got in here. The gate is closed and I'm trapped in the graveyard and I have tears coming down my eyes because I'm freaking out. I called 911 to come open the gate. Bruh, this is not cool. I'm trapped in the graveyard. Who the gets trapped in a graveyard? I need help.
I fucking hate people.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
It's not a high gate.
That's why I hate people. You can't figure out how to climb over a gate at a graveyard?
Well, doesn't she have a car? It looks like a car light. It looks like her car is stuck behind the fence.
But she's not trapped.
Yeah, she could hop the fence.
She could at least hop the fence and then try to figure some shit out.
She doesn't sound physically fit to me.
True. But you would still figure out how to get over a fucking gate, no?
Yeah, you could roll over. So yeah, you could get under or over something.
We're looking at a gate that, 4 feet, maybe 4.5 feet, tops?
When she said, bruh, I was like, this is not an emergency. This can wait.
Yeah, that is headlights. So Jimmy's right. That's her car. But still, you could at least get out of the graveyard, take your fucking car keys, leave a note on your car. I'm a dummy. I'll come back and get this tomorrow. You're not stuck there officially. And now she's calling 911. To get her out of there.
But she might live 8 miles from there. Like, who wants to walk 8 miles with your car in a graveyard? It just sucks. It's all creepy and shit.
Call a friend.
Yeah.
Get over yourself.
Or go through the fucking fence.
Right.
Every movie has someone going through a fence.
You have another Pokemon story if you want.
I love these Pokemon stories because it just shows how stupid people
are. Is it about someone catching one?
Well, this is even better. A guy, you know what? Just play it.
Okay.
Just play it. You don't need me send this off.
He just wanted to battle real life.
Grove Band says that he was stabbed while playing Pokemon Go. Now, the new game is sweeping the nation. It encourages everybody to get out and catch them all, as they say.
The thing is, while you may have seen more people out and about searching for those
more hand gestures, please.
The latest tech is
better than look at his hands are doing, just fucking hanging there like mannequin arms.
I know.
Ready to strangle.
Yeah, his little fat hands.
they are nice and chubby, aren't they?
Look at his little fucking chubby, biteable hands.
Oh, he does. That one looks so fat at the top. They look baked.
Yeah. It's like this guy likes a little salt at lunch.
Yeah.
He's a color of a nice water detention turkey. In his hands.
Right. Nice gout fingers.
they are fucking plump.
Yeah. His fingers look delicious.
And he's just sitting there going, man, I wish I could move my hands like she is.
Yeah, he's in awe of her hand movements.
She's a gesturing fool.
Her dexterity.
Right. All right, go back some to danger. Fox 12.
Fox 12's Megha Sugianto spoke to the man who explains what happened.
She moves them and they're heavy, they fall back.
He was determined to catch all the Pokemon he could get around 1 this morning. So when he saw a man near the intersection of 19 and Filbert, he thought it would be a good opportunity for a Pokemon challenge. But instead, he got something more than that.
A Pokemon challenge.
It's like a smokescreen thing.
It's been 21-year-old Michael Baker's dream to play his childhood game in real life.
Too long. It's been too long.
That's your dream?
Biting my nails on it, you know.
Yeah. He's the haircut of every school shooter.
When the game Pokemon Go came out, he was set on being the best.
Basically, risk my life.
The game uses GPS, so you have to get up and get moving to play. When you see them, you capture it. The game also allows people to challenge each other.
He just wanted to battle real life.
Early Monday morning, Michael was walking near his home in Forest Grove to catch as many Pokemons as possible.
Pokemons.
And he saw another man, possibly playing the same game.
I saw him go by and I was like, you playing Pokemon Go or whatever, you know? And he's like, what? I was like, Pokemon Go. And then like, I guess he wanted the battle or something because he just came at me with the knife. So.
I'm 100% on the other guy's side.
I'm sorry,
that
dude.
That is probably the funniest time to stab someone.
Yeah.
Playing Pokemon Go. Yeah. Right. The thing I was hitting on him. Pokemon Go.
Right.
It means like I'll fuck you in the ass, then you can hit the bricks, pal.
Right.
Pokemon Go. All
right, I'll battle with you. A real life battle.
Some dumb kid with a Lego haircut.
Yeah, some creeper with a fucking... no personality. Are we playing Pokemon Go?
Yeah. And a little callback. You got to be hating his bangs there, Theo Von.
Yeah, that kid definitely. Actually, those look a little more fluttered than I felt like Jim Florentine's look.
All right, yeah. Theo went after Florentine's bangs the other day, Sam. You're good.
I apologize.
Sam
doesn't outside.
Sam doesn't have bangs.
I have Jewy hair, so it's whichever. Yeah. I'll never drop that kind of money on a haircut.
Do you guys iron it out ever? You guys kind of, what is that called?
I do nothing.
Yeah.
I just, you know, accept the loss.
You got those natural curls, though. I like curls, man. I would have curls if I could have it.
Oh, I appreciate
a perm?
It, man.
Yeah. My mother won a perm once on the radio, actually. That's true.
Oh, no.
She won a perm on the radio? Yeah. What a shitty radio station. That's horrible prize.
Yeah.
Was she excited?
We were excited when she came home with it, man.
She got to sit next to Rand Paul for a day.
She looked fired up.
She got the Frenchie from Greece.
she was fired up.
It was tight. Yeah. I never she just had a little more pepper.
A little sass.
Yeah. All it was the only one she ever had. She got
it. My mom went through a perm phase too. It was terrible. A fucking perm.
Was it a little too tight? I hate when they're a little too tight.
Perms are the worst.
Not a fan.
I hate a perm.
Dang.
Perms were all the rage for a while there.
They were, right?
Yes, they were.
Was it Molly Ringwald inspired those in the 80s? Like, re-inspired them?
God, I don't even know. That's a good question.
Phil Spector had a great perm.
Yeah, he sure did.
But I forgot how bad hair was in the 80s until I see old pictures of girls I loved in high school. They were, like, the most beautiful girls. I'm like, oh, my God, that was so 80s.
They had the waterfall bangs.
With the big hair?
How did we ever get hard-ons? Oh, you guys are too young to even know this
These chicks look like David Bowie at his worst.
Yeah.
Show the waterfall bangs for these youngsters. It was the worst.
Mm.
They would be really, really hot, and then they all wore their hair like this. I think you got to put in like the early 90s or late
80s.
Waterfall bangs in the 80s. There's not even a good example here.
Those were such 80 haircuts. Wow.
Yeah, these are real fucking hairstyles.
Wow. That's beautiful.
It all looks like Ozzy Osbourne.
She looks like Chewbacca.
Yeah, that's a real, that's an Ozzy fucking shot in the dark video haircut.
Absolutely, it is. Go back to the guy that got stabbed in the Pokemon. I want to hear more from this
playing
guy.
Playing Pokemon Go? What?
Yeah, I am, motherfucker.
Oh, and then like, I guess he wanted the battle or something, because he just came at me with the knife, so I didn't expect it to happen, and it was pretty brief and fast, like, just slice and ran.
He says he didn't go to the hospital because he still wanted to hunt for characters and other things.
Right after I was stabbed, I continued my mission to Plaid Pantry to get chips and beer.
What's that?
Other players say they've seen news stories around the game. One person in Wyoming stumbled upon a body while playing. And police in Missouri say a group used the game to rob people.
That's just, that's crazy. Like, it's just a game, but people are going to get killed for it because people are obsessed and want to be the best.
Definitely a close call.
As for Michael, he says he'll be careful next time, but will continue his mission to be the best.
No, it's very important to me, you know. I got to pretty much catch them all.
Michael.
That's what these kids think, man. It's real to them.
It's still real to me, damn it. Right, the wrestling guy.
It's like a bouncing ball on your phone.
Oh, my God.
Jesus shit.
Here, go play the rest of this, because I love when they go back to the studio. Yeah, we're just about
eight stitches.
Her shirt's enraging.
Police say they have not made any arrests on this case, and they're not going to release any information on the suspect. Reporting in Forest Grove tonight.
I wonder why.
Fox 12. War.
Yeah, I wonder what's going on there, huh?
I wonder why they won't release information on the suspect.
Yeah, I wonder why.
I wonder why. All right. I think that's all the Pokemon Go stories for today.
Yeah.
Every day there's a few that pop out.
Can't wait.
Yeah, you guys weren't in here. Theo might have been. They don't want you to play Pokemon Go at the Holocaust Museum. They're begging people to stop playing at the Holocaust Museum.
They don't need any more victims.
Right.
And no Pokemon.
And the 9/11 Memorial here in New York City. They're like, please don't play Pokemon Go.
Well, they're suspecting that's what happened actually on 9/11. Both pilots are just playing Pokemon Go.
And we're distracted by it.
Yes.
Yes. Speaking of the hood, you got a woman, a white woman walking in the black neighborhood. Jimmy was enraged by this a little bit yesterday.
Oh, no, I thought this lady was very good. She was very, hello, Lorella Willis.
We got video of this too, right?
Yeah.
White woman walks in black neighborhood. I'm sorry, black America.
Good, good, good. That's important.
What is this about? Is this someone that just needs attention?
I think so. Or she probably means it and she needs attention. She's probably a bunch of things.
I think there's definitely some me going on in here.
Oh my. To think that you have, don't apologize for things you didn't do, you silly goose.
I wonder what she did. She probably has something in her closet, you know?
Yeah.
Dude, she's got some guilt she's trying to get out, right?
She might.
What's her guilt?
Why is this a news story? Asshole with sign walks around.
Yeah, you're giving her exactly what she wants.
How is that news?
This is Chicago, too. My God, that's pretty brave to go in a black neighborhood in Chicago.
I'll bet you that she was just playing Pokemon. This whole thing was a ruse. She had her fucking phone under the sign and she didn't want to get mobbed. So she wanted black people to be on her side.
I bet she got hit on a bunch, too, actually.
Let's see what she looks like.
Yeah, let's check this story out.
Just four words, but her methods are raising some eyebrows and turning heads on Chicago's South Side.
CBS2's Audrina Bigas talks to the lady with the sign in this original report.
Oh, thank you. The original report.
She's good calves.
It's touching, especially someone who's not colored and making a stand for what is right.
I commend her for her courage to do that, but we need more.
A thumbs Spike up, Lee. A wave, head turns, and pictures. In Inglewood, a white woman stopping people in their tracks.
Wait, what was that?
The black guy was like happy to see it.
Yeah. He's on a hoverboard.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Outside a firehouse.
And they go. And if they pan farther to the left, there's going to be a white kid with a lump on his head looking for his hoverboard.
A pink hoverboard. I've only seen the actual lady for 10 seconds. No doubt in my mind, she's just mentally ill.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at a mentally ill person. Are they going to bring that into this story?
Her legs look great. She has legs like a mentally ill person who just walks around the neighborhood all day.
Yeah, just doing loops.
Yeah.
Those are cargo shorts, too.
Talking to themselves.
Yeah.
Cargo shorts.
Definite sign of mental illness.
Kind of woman.
What did you say to her?
I was just saying I like what she's doing.
But that's the big question. What is she doing and why?
To me, that's me doing my part.
Walking about 20 miles in one day, sunburnt and sweating, with a public apology. Black America, I'm sorry.
What are you sorry about?
Everything that's going on in America. I don't want to continue to see
Black
America being oppressed and held down and killed.
She looks like that D.B. Cooper fucking picture that the FBI finally closed the case on. That's her. It's D.B. Cooper. Sorry.
After 45 years, they said, fuck it. Keep the money. Keep the money. Enjoy the remaining maybe year of your life. He's got to be a real old dude if he's around.
Yeah.
D.W. Cooper?
No, D.B.
D.B. Cooper, right. D.B. Cooper.
I think W.D. Fard was like in the beginning of the Nation of Islam. Am I crazy to think that?
I don't know.
W.D. Fard?
I'm out. I have no idea. This woman is mentally ill and possibly looking for black dick.
Yeah.
Someone's got to say it. She's looking for black dick.
Well, the one brother was getting her number.
Yeah.
I'm only a party of one, but I'm going to give you all the support that I have.
You really just, you can't make a statement against this statement.
WVON radio host Mark Wallace spotted Lorella walking on 87th.
No one put her up to this, and she woke up and decided, white America, there's a problem, and we have to acknowledge it and do something about it.
She admits she doesn't know what's next, but she says sitting at
here's the problem. Of course you can make a statement against it.
Yeah.
She's apologizing for something that she's not... You don't. It's an empty statement. It doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
Just some lady looking for attention. Yeah, but it's condescending.
But I don't even need to go that far because I feel like I'm just looking at a mentally ill lady.
Yeah.
Yeah, I say that. I think that every time I fuck.
She doesn't seem all there.
Uh-uh.
And if you're a radio host, you should have some awareness that this guy...
Because they like the message. If that was the mayor or someone that was a policymaker, or if that was, fucking Strom Thurmond, that's different. But it's not.
You can say you're upset with what's going on, but to say, I'm sorry... Is mentally ill.
Yeah. What'd you do? I'm pretty nice. I'm nice to black people.
Yeah.
Smile at them. Words of encouragement. You can do it.
I've done my part. I say what up when I see one. Go, what up?
Good morning.
Right. Yeah. I acknowledge.
Yeah. I'll say things like, Ty Cobb was wrong.
All right. Let's get to the end of this nonsense story.
Decided, white America, there's a problem. And we have to acknowledge it and do something about it.
Is there a black man who doesn't have a salmon-colored shirt we can talk to?
They tend to like that color. Those people.
Next, but she says sitting at home won't fix a thing.
I don't want to hear lip service from anyone. I want action. This mother
she wants some black action.
Right? Not part of any organization.
Wow, look at these boobs. What is this lady saying?
South side, and she is looking for other ways to
Jesus.
Help with everything that's
going on. Oh, those tits are causing more accidents than Pokemon.
Look at this. That is a hell of a ghetto ass.
That matters right there.
She is a lovely
That matters right there. Wow-wee.
That is...
Very, very chesty young lady.
Very curvy, this one.
That's the new look, man. Those big, huge hooters close to the butt, you know?
I'd say big tits are not exactly a new fad, though.
Yeah, that's a good point.
People have been a fan for a long time.
That'll never go away.
Yeah, even Jay Mansfield with her fucking head was laying in the street, people were grabbing her tits real quick.
I like the small ones, man. I like them heaters, the little.
I prefer them to bigger nipples, darker nipples, big areolas, like B cups. C cups are nice. But anyone who's like, I got double D, I don't need it.
Yeah.
You think? It's like really big tits are like avocados. They go bad. You know?
Avocados go bad?
Oh, God.
How did they? I've never had a bad avocado.
Oh, no. I mean,
that's the name of my new book.
I've never had a bad avocado.
It's strawberries for me.
Yeah.
The shelf life of strawberries.
Not long.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. They look so wonderful in the supermarket, and within an hour on your counter, they're fucking growing shit on them.
Yeah. You know, they look good, and then they're all bruised.
What the fuck?
They look like the fucking the legs of a cancer patient. Like no one's turned them in a while.
I don't know what's up with strawberries. They're tricking us. How do they keep them fresh in the supermarket?
They freeze. I think they're frozen. And they're frozen, and when you get them, they're not fresh. I love a good fresh strawberry. I mean, we can go to break on
that. Ooh, we can talk about your favorite fruit. She's curvy. I think with big boobs, I think every guy starts out really liking big boobs. And then don't you sort of grow out of it? Some don't.
I haven't. But I'm still really...
Big tits.
Well, really?
Yeah, this is the first girl I've ever dated who's got big tits, and I'm really soaking it up.
They don't suck.
Oh, I mean, I'm having a great time. You get your first pair, you just try to do everything with them. You're like, push them up, you push them, you have your fun.
Have you ever been with a gal that's the only reason?
And then like a week, but not.
Yeah, and then you try.
I've had fat male friends for that reason.
And then you try to give her attention everywhere else, but you know you're just focusing in on.
I had a friend actually get dumped because he asked his girlfriend to get implants. And he was like crying about it. He was so dumb. He's like, I don't know why she's leaving me. And I'm like, well, you fucking know why.
Exactly.
You can't just ask a girl. And then he dated another girl and she did get implants for him.
Oh, wow.
Why did you find a girl with big tits?
He paid for the implants and then she left him. And he's like, now some other guy's fucking her with my tits.
I kind of respect that, too.
Yeah.
I like the titty fuck.
You do?
But I always do it facing down so my asshole's right over their nose and face. Chum who's boss.
I like the small ones, man. I like the small ones. Yeah, I hate it when you like when a girl has small ones and you have to pretend like they're bigger by like feeling them a lot. It's like you're like just making do for her. You
gotta grab where tits would be if she had them around her on her breastbone.
Can you just end this story?
No, that's the end. I just want to point out where we stopped. You can see he's taking a peek.
A little gander.
Taking a peek. Oh, he's taking a little.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Giant heavy bosoms.
So how they didn't handle that story properly, but it fits into, you know, their agenda. Because that's just a crazy lady.
Yeah.
That was just a crazy lady. And it looks like she cuts her own hair going back to Theo Von. Mm-hmm.
There's activism you can do. That's not activism. You're just walking around acting like an idiot.
Yeah.
And then she got the attention, but she didn't have anything of substance to say about the issue.
No. What was that Bruce Willis sign that he wore in the street?
Oh, my God.
And the sign was honestly pretty shitty.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't have the right to apologize to Black America. It's a very arrogant statement. You're not the person who did these things. You know, you can be sorry that Black America is dealing with stuff, but to apologize like you've done something wrong is embarrassing.
Yeah, she's cutting her own hair.
Speaking of the issue, did you get a...
And my sign said, Black America, you're welcome.
Did you see D.L. Hughley going at it with Megyn Kelly on Fox last night?
I did not.
What happened?
Wow, wee. And Megyn Kelly got extremely heated.
And her
aggressive side came out. Do we have time to do it now?
Yeah, let's watch it. He's a CNN guy. Why was he on there?
I was surprised he went on Fox because he even admits he doesn't like Fox. This was great TV last night. Oh. For real. Big confrontation. D.L. Hughley. All right, here. Let's just play it.
Thank you.
Joining me now with reaction, D.L. Hughley. Actor, radio host, and author of Black Man, White House,
and comedian. Oral
history of the Obama years. D.L., thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. I didn't know Mark Furman was going to be here.
What did you make of it? Because you were shaking your head.
I think that cops have a different perspective than us, and I think it was interesting to hear Mark Furman, who was actually got in trouble for perjuring himself, called somebody a liar. It's ridiculous to me.
Mm-hmm. But what do you make of the fact that she had inconsistencies in her story?
I think the cop had inconsistencies in his too. Mm-hmm. To me.
So then you let the evidence play out.
Here's my problem. No matter,
racism.
It is my belief that no matter what happens, no matter what we see, the cops are given a presumption of innocence. If that same tape showed a suspect doing something, that would be all the prosecution would need. They would say the evidence is all right here. But a cop gets a presumption of innocence that is, no matter what they see, we can see somebody getting shot to death. They go, we don't know what happened before. We don't know what happened after. Mm-hmm. I know this, that in a state, in both these states, a lot of men in Louisiana, 47% of people carry guns. Men carry guns. So men having guns on them can't be that unusual. Why wasn't the first question, rather than assuming, do you have a permit for that? Mm-hmm. Those are states that you can carry a gun.
But you're making assumptions because we don't know what happened.
No.
What we have right now is her testimonial, which doesn't capture the actual event. Do we know whether she's credible? Do we know whether...
We know this. We know he had a permit to carry a gun.
But that doesn't answer any of the questions.
That absolutely answers the question.
If he pulled the firearm on the officer, if he didn't disclose it, if the officer felt threatened.
Why on earth would you... Here's what we do know. He had a permit to carry a gun. When you get a permit to carry a gun, they tell you exactly how to act when a police officer pulls you
off. That doesn't mean he didn't threaten the officer.
You're willing to give them a presumption of innocence.
I'm not giving them presumption. Well, the law gives them the presumption of innocence.
No, they're bad.
I'm saying we don't know the facts. I mean, when we saw this happen with Michael Brown of Ferguson.
And we still don't know the facts there. We have a police officer's word and a grand jury's word.
No, we have the Department of Justice's word.
The Department of Justice shut down Ferguson. Ferguson had to be shut down because it was so corrupt.
The Department of Justice found that the police there had endemic racism. They found that.
Right.
But they also exonerated Officer Derrick Wilson.
That's not a...
And they found Hands Up,
something.
Don't Shoot was a
let
lie.
Let me ask you something.
And that Brown was the aggressor.
Wow. Here's what I'll say.
Don't wow me.
Don't tell me not to wow you. I can say wow if I want to, and
that
I'll tell you
what
this.
They found,
I'll tell you this. They found systemic racism, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's unbelievable. They also found systemic racism, and we know that Darren Wilson left the department because it was so racist it had to be disbanded, and he went to Ferguson, another department that is rife with racism.
So that makes him a racist.
Absolutely. You know what? I have no problem.
Michael Brown grabbed that officer's gun and tried to shoot him in his patrol car.
That is No one has proven that.
Eric Holder's DOJ concluded.
And Eric Holder's DOJ concluded that department was so rife with
corruption. I already conceded that, DL. Hey, Megan, we're talking about Michael Brown and the lie.
Let's be clear.
Of hands up, don't shoot.
I don't dodge at all. I'm here in Fox News.
Then let's stay on Michael Brown.
We're talking about the young man that just got murdered in Minnesota.
And the rush to judgment and the assumption you know something when you don't actually know it. First off,
what I'll tell you is this. It is not uncommon for you all to see one thing. The only place racism doesn't exist is Fox News and the police department. That's absolutely true. That's insulting. You just insulted millions of people watching this channel. And you know what? I'm insulted by the things I hear on this network, so we're even. I could care less about insulting people that insult me on a daily basis.
You're making a point that is, before the insults, the point you started to make is true. And we can talk about that, that whites perceive the situation when it comes to these races.
I think a lot of people on this network have never seen a black man anything deserved.
Could you hold the insults for a second so we can have a productive conversation? You were going to make the points that whites see certain incidents differently than blacks do. And we saw that in the O.J. Simpson case when the verdict came down.
Sure.
I'll give you that. Most reasonable people will give you that. But you know what shuts down all reasonable dialogue is throwing out the term racism before it's been proven.
You know what's first off, I'll say this. I believe that there is a benefit of the doubt given to police officers. It's not given to anybody else. And maybe, yeah, obviously they do a tough job. You can't. In 2006, the FBI came out with a report that said that police departments were rife with white supremacists. Said it, not me. So why wouldn't I believe, if I know that? I don't know a black man that hasn't had a run-in with a police officer, from the highest to the lowest.
So my perception of this is
based on the experience I've had, just like yours are.
Mm-hmm.
So I am not willing to give them a benefit of the doubt. I have seen a lot of things. I lived in the city that Mark Fermor policed that also had to be taken over by the federal government.
It's very dangerous when you get to the point where you paint with an entire group with the same brush based on the bad actions of a few.
That is amazing to hear on this network. The only place racism...
Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Take care.
Wow. And then maybe she had to go to break, but she just, she was done. Well, that's pretty good TV, huh?
That's good. Yeah. That was good. I don't think Roger Ailes did it. And,
what do you think?
I get where he's coming from. I get it why he's angry. It's definitely an emotional issue, you know?
Yeah. They both made decent points. It's like, I don't like when she was going, like, I'll give you that, like, you know, we just see it differently. That's it. Black people and white people experience the police differently. We do.
And how can you not be furious that video of the woman, her husband getting shot in the car? Like, how can you should be furious by that. We don't know what happened that preceded that, but...
It's sickening.
She watched her husband die. Out of context, we don't know what happened. We just see a cop yelling.
Well, they officially married.
Boyfriend. But I tend to believe her in that situation just because of the way she was talking and then she was being calm.
She
seemed like somebody who was kind of in a state of... But then the cop seems like he panicked. He didn't seem like he hates black people. He's freaking out. He was an Asian guy, right? He wasn't even a white guy. He's fucking just freaking out that he had just shot somebody.
But then he's incompetent. And then that's beyond racism. Like, these cops have to be better trained then. I mean, it's fucking terrible.
But the problem is, when you go and become a police officer, they send you to the worst neighborhoods, the younger guys.
Right. Yeah.
So they have the least amount of experience, and they have to deal with way more than, you know, a veteran cop that goes to a much safer neighborhood. I had someone recently, they went into the police force, and they were sent uptown immediately. And, you know, the veterans, and I'm not blaming, I'm just stating facts. And then the older guys, because they got years under their belt, they're on the Upper West Side, just, you know, it's not as bad.
Yeah, right, sure.
So you got guys that really don't have the experience yet, dealing with a lot of stuff right off the bat.
That's true.
Not making excuses for any of these guys. And then, like you said, this guy was all nervous, a nervous Nelly, and fired on this guy in the car.
Yeah.
But to Megyn Kelly's point, we truly don't know what happened before she turned on that phone. Did the guy make some aggressive move that we don't know about? I don't know. I feel like he probably didn't. But to be fair, we don't know what happened.
How many guys? He's not a criminal.
Right.
I believe. He'd never been in trouble.
Right.
So how many guys who are not criminals, who haven't been in trouble, who are licensed to carry a firearm, tell a cop, I have a gun, hold on, let me get it and shoot you.
Right.
Sure.
That just doesn't make sense to me.
I agree with you.
And how many of these cops have not been punished for killing a black guy? So many of these cops have been just let off. And that, like, again and again, if you're black, you're just like, oh, we're second-class citizens.
Oh, I would definitely think that, I think, if I were black.
Yeah.
You know? But also, like, a lot of these cops aren't even, they're not, a lot of them aren't the most educated dudes. Like, they're not even paying these guys a lot of money, you know? Like, I feel like if we paid them more, we'd get more dudes who are able to make better decisions. I don't know, man.
I think not a lot of people see those videos that go viral. Not a lot of, like, you know, liberal people see that and are like, I want to become a cop.
Yeah.
Like, I'll help this, you know?
Yeah.
Well, that's the other problem here. I mean, what cop's going to want to do their job?
Yeah.
Why would you want to?
It's
fucking
a thankless job.
It's a total. It already was a thankless job.
Yeah,
but DL's right. We do give them a presumption, but you have. There's a certain amount of thing. Like, you're also sending them into a situation, going, there's the most awful things happening. Go clean that up for me. Go deal with it.
Right.
So you know, they're dealing with stuff the average citizen is never going to deal with. So you have to give them a bit more fucking leeway. Come on.
And they don't get a lot of support. They don't get a lot of money, like Theo said. Well, I know a lot of cops. They have to come in from, you know, Long Island and Queens and all that for their jobs because they can't afford to get a you know, an apartment in the area they protect.
Well, that's crazy. And then I think now a lot of these areas need to start doing ride along things with their local politicians, so the politicians understand what they're going through, so they see the worst of it.
That's a good idea.
Yeah,
that's a good call.
Like, we talk about body cams. Well, it's like, well, we're talking about body cams in the worst possible situations, the worst scenarios. Use the body cams also to show what the average night of a cop is like. It's not easy. So you know, you got to see what they're going through also.
And they're drastically underpaid.
Oh,
they're
they're overpaid as far as I'm concerned. Too much money to the goddamn cops.
And, like, a lot of these guys, like, are getting, like, cops show up on a lot of black people, and there's a lot of times they have guns. There's a lot of instances where they're probably scared, you know, in a lot of these neighborhoods, and, you know, just because of precedent, and they probably don't know what to do.
It's hard.
Well, you can't blame Obama.
It's hard for me to believe that a cop...
Boo, terrible joke.
It's hard for me to believe that the cop goes out there with the intention of killing a black guy. He wants to go home to his fucking family at the end of the day.
That's true. I think some of them probably do, though. I know some racist dudes that are cops, for sure.
So they'll give it a little extra?
I think, yeah, they would probably shoot twice instead of once.
I don't think you're wrong, but I think that number is way lower than Black Lives Matter like to think it is.
Yeah.
Way low. Extremely low.
And there's a lot of black cops, too. Like, I wonder what they're thinking. Like, I wonder what they think about a lot of this.
What do they say? Blue first?
And the black cops are looked at as Uncle Tom's, right? Really?
Yeah.
Right? By the black neighborhoods?
I don't know. I mean, I think they're known as being a very, like, in black neighborhoods, a lot of times they say black cops are worse than white cops, but or harsher to deal with, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't have experience.
I don't even know they still look at Uncle Tom's anymore. Like, I guess they do, there are that term, but it's people don't.
Yeah, there's
it's kind of an old school
term. The more modern term, I think, is Samuel L. Jackson and Django, is what they call him now.
Samuel.
I'd rather be a black cop, I think, because they're usually more jacked and stuff.
Yeah.
They don't let themselves go as quickly.
Yeah, white cops fall apart, I feel like.
Yeah.
Oh, boy, the phones are now lit.
Oh, shit.
Well, we have to take a break. We could certainly go to the phones.
Yeah, let's take the phone calls when I come back. Let's hear everybody.
Yeah, we'll go to the phones
police.
After the break if you could hold on for a minute or two. Sam in studio, Sam Morrell. What do you got, buddy? Tonight through Saturday, the Comedy Attic in Bloomington, Indiana.
Yeah.
Oh, so you're flying out.
I'm flying out after this, straight to the airport.
Good for you.
Comedy Attic next weekend, 22nd, 23rd. I'll be in D.C. Draft House. And actually next Tuesday, I'll be in the Green Mountain Comedy Fest. And the last one, definitely come August 24th, Orlando. I'm at Space Bar. That's a door deal, so please come out to that so I don't regret coming to Orlando. And then I'll be at Side Splitters in Tampa.
That's a good
weekend.
Attitude with a city that's healing.
Well, they need some laughs down there. Theo Vaughn, what do you got, buddy?
I'm going to be in Naples, August 4th through 7th at Off the Hook. They have good food there. And I'll be at September 2nd and 3rd here in New York City at Gotham Comedy Club.
I love when someone promotes a gig by saying they have good food there. What makes their food good?
They just have good seafood. Like, you can eat crab legs and stuff. They take care of
you. Oh, I love that. I love good seafood.
Oh, and they take care of the comedians.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah, you go in early and eat right when you get there, and you eat late again.
That's the way to do
it. You get two meals in?
Yeah.
If you do it right?
Yeah, I love that, man.
Smart.
I'm fired up. I'm already excited.
All right. Jimmy.
I have the 21st, I'll be in Columbus at the Capitol Theater. And then July 22nd, Friday, I will be in Thornville at the Gathering of the Juggalos. Coming up, those dates that have been moved, I'm getting people on Facebook telling me like that they were going to come. I apologize. It's very rare I ever have to move gigs. But Minnesota and Pittsburgh have both been moved. They are now Thursday, September 15th in Minneapolis, and then September 16th in Pittsburgh. They just got moved. It had to happen, but I didn't cancel them. I just rescheduled. And then September 24th, I'm in Toronto. And the new UFC podcast is up. This was a really good one. Today's was a really good
one. What do you got?
We have Eddie Alvarez and Johanna Jędrzejczyk, the strawweight.
Yeah,
I love her.
Very cool. Okay. Yeah. And the OP Radio podcast today on iTunes and all the usual places. We got Wheeler Walker Jr., 8-Track Porn. We dug deep into the archives.
They had that?
There used to be 8-Track Porn. We did a whole bit on it. It's a classic bit, really.
Yeah.
Eric dug deep for the podcast this week. Subscribe and review on iTunes, also available on Google Play. I forgot, I didn't forget, but Daryl Strawberry right around the corner. His 30 for 30, Doc and Daryl, premieres tonight at 9 on ESPN. He's coming in to say hi and promote that.
And Ron Funches will be in at 9:30. Right.
Nice.
And I don't think Daryl's coming with his wife.
That, I bet he does.
I heard
she hot.
Huh?
She hot chick.
What are you being rude? You're actually being rude. He's spraying, trying to make the place better.
Why are you pushing out farts? Is there a reason today?
It was Paul.
You got butt gas. Yeah.
You got it? Daryl's coming alone.
Okay, that was a roid fart, Paul.
Yeah, good man. He sounds strong.
We're gonna have Daryl after the break, so then we might have to go back to the calls a little later. We're not blowing it off. If you want, and what? And a Pokemon Go app leads gamers to sex offenders rehab facility. Oh, Jesus! All right, we got lots to do.
Big Richard.
Busy room. Sam Morril. Theo Von before he heads back to L.A. or wherever the hell he goes.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me, man.
I feel like you're a wanderer. I feel like you don't have a place yet.
Yeah.
That you could call home. And you're okay with that. That's the feeling I get.
I think I need to get a wife. I think that'll help me settle down.
You want a wife?
I think I want a wife or an animal.
Well, then you should make a decision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Then you got to stop going into strangers' apartments to get haircuts.
Jesus Christmas. Yeah.
I don't think the wife's going to understand that.
I've made some poor choices in that, man.
Guy fucking stood out before you got there. He was shooting rubber cement into a woman's face as Botox.
But the haircut is just amazing.
It looks good too, right?
It's a solid haircut.
It's a nice haircut. Great job. Guy probably had one of those. He probably had a tattoo between his thumb and pointer finger on that soft spot. Fucking prison tattoo in Mexico he got. Cutting the throat of the hitchhiker.
I don't even know if he had one eye. It could have. I might have been a glass eye. Yeah.
Oh, you never stare. You gotta fucking be on your best behavior.
Yeah, remember Sandy Duncan?
Yeah.
Who would you put in if you had a glass eye? Would you put just a glass eye? What would you put in there?
Yeah, I would have to
find a bullet.
Just sticking out? That's awesome.
No, going in.
What are the other options? Just leave the socket and horrify people?
Yeah.
Maybe an eye patch. Right. Eye patch is kind of cool.
Eye patch is rule. It's interesting. Yeah. Slick Rick it up. I love an eye patch.
Yeah. Maybe blinds.
What happened to you?
Like a little blinds.
We had a guy completely blind come in here to do some blind boxing.
Really?
Great dude.
But the guy he was fighting could see perfectly.
Wow.
He popped both eyes out. The only time I saw eye sockets.
Oh, God.
He popped them both out for us for the shock of it. It was deeply disturbing.
Yeah. He smelled the back of them.
Can he hand them around? Can he do that?
I don't remember if we... Were you there that day, Jimmy?
I don't remember.
I don't remember handling the actual eyeballs, but I do remember he popped them out and gave us a nice look. There's a picture online somewhere.
That's bizarre.
E-Rock could find in the old O&A archives.
I'd go with a ruby, I think.
Maybe. A ruby?
Or a Halloween, like a... snow globe or something. Right. Something bizarre.
A grape. A
magic 8-ball.
A magic 8-ball.
Where's Daryl Strawberry? Is he making his way down
Speaking
to the studio?
Speaking of eight balls.
Ah, this guy, Daryl, and Doc and Daryl actually is the 30 for 30 on
ESPN. I didn't know it was about Strawberry. I thought it was about Doc Severinsen from the Tonight Show.
you guys see the 30 for 30?
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
It's really, really good.
So intense.
Yeah.
Very intense.
About Doc and Daryl.
Oh, yeah. My God.
It's just frustrating because both those guys should be in the Hall of Fame. They don't have the numbers to support that.
Travis said they do.
No.
Talking about.
But those guys, it seemed like it was a no-brainer. Someday they'd be in the Hall of Fame. But their numbers, because of all the problems they had on and off the field, they fell way short. Like, way short. They'll never be in the Hall of Fame, right?
Oh, no, of course not.
I don't even think either of them are even on the ballot anymore. Like, you need a certain percentage to stay on the ballot. I don't think either of them are even possible.
So,
but I mean, Daryl telling those stories about being like, I'd be fucking just gone hitting two home runs. I mean, that's insane.
That's crazy.
To be able to hit a major league pitcher, two home runs.
Yeah.
I like fun baseball stories. Remember that time we were at the park early and it was so sunny? You didn't see the ball because of the sun.
My favorite is Keith Hernandez in this doc because he seemed like he was like kind of like the dad of the group.
Right.
You know, he's like, yeah, we partied, but.
But Keith was drinking like white wine or something.
Exactly.
And the rest of them casual.
And the rest of them were doing fucking greenies, crack, everything they could get their hands on. Like, who was the one that told us? Was it in the 30 for 30 or was it Lenny Dykstra when he came through? The greenies would make the ball look huge.
Daryl said that in the documentary.
Damn. It was in the documentary? Okay. I'm getting two stories mixed up. He said, you know, it was so easy to hit that ball because the greenies made it look like a fucking, what did he say, like a volleyball or something. Can you imagine?
It's so bizarre he would even do that just to be that out there. They wouldn't do that now, I bet.
Everybody was doing it, though.
Yeah.
Everybody. And Major League Baseball knew they had a drug problem. They knew. And then they knew with the steroids years later. But they didn't give a fuck. Because it was bringing people into the stadium.
It seems like if you didn't do the greenies, you were like, they said like you weren't doing enough to help your team win.
Yeah.
That's right.
Huh. They would just hand them out.
Which I fucking love.
Everyone was just fucking speeding their faces off.
Yeah.
That's crazy. I couldn't even be on drugs and watch baseball, I don't think. Playing would just be bizarre, man.
I don't understand speeding, how that makes you a better hitter, though.
Focus,
wouldn't
maybe.
Wouldn't you all be just fucking jittery, though?
I don't know. He said that laser-like focus, I guess.
Right.
It helps you zoom in.
Zoom in on that baseball.
Maybe everything faster. You see. I don't know.
Maybe that's one question to ask him. Daryl's, he's all right, man. He looks great in the 30 for 30.
Yeah.
And then Doc.
Doc does not.
Fuck.
Slender.
Yeah, he looks a little like he might have caught something.
We had him in here once, and he looked all right. But in this 30 for 30, he was just jonesing is the only way to put it. He was just shaking his ass off.
Yeah, it was
when they
upsetting.
Were doing the shots from the booth.
I thought he was a lot older. He looked coked up. Just that was coke movement almost. But again, maybe he was.
And how quickly he was talking, it seemed very coked out.
Yeah, very jittery.
And he looks like like 10 years. They showed that picture from just 10 years ago. And you're like, oh, he's a different looking dude.
Gaunt. He looked like kind of haunted a little bit.
And Daryl just looked very, very healthy.
I wonder if he has any money left, Doc Gooden.
Oh, God, I doubt it.
Oh, no way.
There's no
He did that last scene where he's doing that dinner party. And dude, you don't do that if you got money saved up.
Mm-mm.
Well, they showed him leaving his house on Long Island. It's not the type of house you would think Doc Gooden would be living in.
The city has an estimated worth of $2.5
million. Wow.
All right.
Maybe he made something from the book, or maybe he might do well on signings. He's still Doc Gooden.
Yeah, I'm sure he could get some pocket money signing some baseballs.
Yeah, he's tall.
But that's a guy that should have been, you know, completely just ridiculously rich and set for life. 2.5 doesn't mean you're set for life, right?
No.
Most people would like to have 2.5 in the bank. I understand that. But we're talking about Doc Gooden. He had a hell of a future that just was cut short. By all this shit. We're kind of stalling because they said Daryl's finishing up a...
How about they get him?
A phone call. Yeah, we're on time. How about he be on time?
Well, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure his organization is...
Have y'all had Jim McMahon in here?
No.
The player? No.
Yeah.
Love to talk to Jim McMahon.
I partied with him one night.
Did you?
Yeah.
Really?
That guy can drink and just smoking pots, partying.
He's having a good time. A story came out about the fridge recently that we had on this show. He's living in like an old age home.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes.
Heavy guy.
Can't fucking walk anymore. Fucking pees in his, what was it, an Escalade? We just did the story about a week or two ago. Doesn't give a fuck.
Just pees in his Escalade?
Just standing outside of it. It's a really weird choice.
That's crazy. I wouldn't do that.
Has no fucking money left.
He sits in his car and drinks all day.
So
he just pisses there because he doesn't want
to
get up.
Right. Because it's too much of a problem to get into his wheelchair to go find somewhere to pee.
Some of this,
he's 450 pounds. Lives alone in a retirement facility.
Yeah, I bet the under, dude. It's not going to be. That's not going to go over well, probably.
I think he's already at that point. That
what
it's
age
not
is
going
he?
Well. He's not that old. Probably in his mid-50s, maybe.
Yeah.
Daryl Strawberry.
What's up, guys?
How are you, buddy?
I'm good.
You're looking good.
Doing good. How you guys doing, man?
Good. We're good. How's your morning going?
Morning's going great.
Yeah?
Got up, man. Woke up, buddy.
See you again, sir.
How you doing, man? Right. Good to see you.
Good to see you again. Where's your wife?
Oh, she's not here. She's in the prison preaching right now in Illinois.
Oh, she's doing some preaching?
Yeah. But
no guy wants to hear that when he walks in a room, though. Where's your wife?
She was very nice to us. And,
she's Midwestern girl.
And she kind of helped change your life around, right?
Of course.
Yeah, of course she did.
That's why it's still going.
You look great, brother.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
And I say that because we saw the 30 for 30. I went to the premiere a couple weeks ago. These guys saw it as well. And the difference between you and Doc, it has to be said. It's sad. You look really healthy in the thing, and he looks like he's struggling.
Yeah, well, you know, addiction is real. You know, a lot of people don't understand how serious it is when in one's life. You know, and it takes your life. It takes your life away. You know, I see so many young people in my treatment center that are struggling with the same thing. You know, heroin and opiates and. You know, 18 to 25, they're addicted and they're losing their life, man. It's not a game. It's not a joke.
Right.
You know, I try to help them, make them understand that they can recover. And that's what's really important.
Yeah.
And that's why this film is so important, so people can see how real addiction is and where it takes you. It doesn't matter how rich you are, how successful you are.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know, it once you get addicted, it's your personality is addicted to it.
Right. How'd they approach you about doing this? They just said, look, we want to talk about you and Doc Gooden or the addiction or what happened or what could have been or what was their way of getting you to do it?
Well, their approach to a dear friend of mine is like Gary Green. You know, he's a dear friend of me and Doc's, and he approached me and asked me would I be interested in, like, possibly doing a 30 for 30 with Doc. I said, the only way I could do it if it's real, you know, if it's raw and, you know, they could really tell the story, they could show the real side of who I was, you know, the liar, the cheater, the womanizer, the alcoholic, the drug addict. You need to show it all. And then you need to show the other side of what can happen if you change. And I said, if we can go down that road, I'll go down that road.
Wow. See, that's really brave. Most people wouldn't want all that out there.
Well, how can you help someone else if you're a liar? If you're pretending that you're well?
Yeah.
You know, how can you help? We can't help people if we do that. You know, and I know that game, and I know that game because I played it. That's what professional sports is like. You know, people say they want to help you, but do they really want to help you?
Yeah.
You know, do they want to help you so what you can do for them? Are they really sincere about helping a person? It's like I'm in the field of addiction, you know, and I'm in the field of running treatment centers, and I see people, and they just want to know that their life matters. You know, even though they're struggling, because everybody's giving up on them, because they have a problem with some type of substance, you know, and that doesn't mean that life is over. That means that they have some deep-rooted issue inside of themselves. Something's happened. They never dealt with it. And they started using, and using allowed them to escape.
You're right.
From feeling.
Right.
And that's when it becomes pain. See, my pain of my beatings from my father, and he was an alcoholic and coming home beating and pulling out shotguns. My pain led me into my greatness to be a baseball player. But my greatness led me into the destructive behavior of my life.
Mm. Did you ever see him again? That was interesting to hear, too, in the documentary, how he would lay you down and hit you. And he said, you said one time he came home and you guys just picked up bats. And what happened?
Well, he pulled out a shotgun and said he was going to kill all of us. He was drunk, you know, and we went into action. I was 13, my brother was 14, and my other brother was 15. He told my older brother, Michael, told him, just get out here and leave us alone. And he pulled out a shotgun and said, I'll kill all of you. And that's when we went into action. And see, people only look at the uniform, but they don't look at the tragedy that could have happened before I put on the uniform. But the scars were already there, you know, before I even put on the uniform. But like I said, my pain led me to excel because he said I would never be anything. And I wanted to prove him wrong that I would be.
Did you ever see him again after that?
I saw him about 3 years ago.
Yeah, oh, he's still alive. Okay.
Yeah, he's still alive. My father's still alive. I saw him about 3 years ago, and I went to the hospital, and I repented to him and asked him to forgive me for keeping him out of my life. Nothing but what he done to me.
Had he tried to get back in once you became, you know, Darryl Strawberry on the Mets?
Well, of course, but I never allowed him to be a part of my life, my career. And, you know, two wrongs don't make a right. And I felt like I needed to go back and ask him, you know, to forgive me.
I'm amazed by that.
Wow, yeah.
I don't think I'd be able to do that.
Yeah, do you think you were wrong for keeping him out? If he was such a bad influence, yeah, and he was so abusive, and not like a misunderstanding, he was genuinely abusive, maybe you were right to go, I don't want this person
around. Yeah, but see, we never know what people go through. We wasn't there when he was growing up. So we don't know what his struggle was, you know. Come and find out his father was an alcoholic, and he saw his... His father beat his mother, you know, to death. You know,
it's death.
Yeah,
wow.
So it's real struggles, you know, that we don't know about certain things, and you know, how do we judge, you know, judge others, and we have our own things to overcome, and you know, and I came to that place after, you know, I got, you know, set free in my life, and you start living a liberated life, and I came to that place that how can I judge him, you know, when I had a bunch of, you know, my own bunch of issues and wrongs that I've done.
So you didn't see him for over 30 years before that?
I used to see him off and on.
Oh, here and there. Okay.
Yeah. And, there was nothing there. I was angry, you know, and I was
bitter.
Would
he ever apologize or anything, or would he ever try to talk to you?
Excuse me. No, he just didn't know how to approach me and talk to me. You know, here it is, you know, he see this kid, you know, and he see this family that he had, and he made it so dysfunctional, and he got rid of us and didn't want us. And so we felt left alone. We felt empty. So here it is. He's got a son that becomes a star in Major League Baseball, and he tries to connect, and I never let him connect. You know, and it wasn't until I got to the place and got over my own issues in my life and got my life straightened out with my wife, Tracy, and got on the right road, that she taught me a lot of things about going back and making amends to people. And that's what I did. I made amends to him. I made amends to my first two wives and the kids and everybody that I hurt, because you know, I was very selfish. I was very self-centered. It was always about me and what I wanted. And I needed to do that to heal. And that's a healing process that every addict has to go through when he does someone wrong.
He was in the hospital when you saw him?
He was in the hospital.
And was he surprised to hear from you?
He was. He was very surprised that I would come down and, you know, I asked him to forgive me, and I laid on his lap and I cried. I wept.
Did you tell him that you were great in spite of him? Like that his abuse is partially responsible for your greatness as an athlete?
No, I never. I never told him that. That was where my pain led me. You know, when I came through baseball, and a lot of people don't know, I came close to quitting in Lynchburg, Virginia, and stuff like that. And the Mets asked me, don't quit, give it another year, and I came
back. Why were you going to quit?
Because I played down in Lynchburg, and there was a lot of racial slurs, you know.
It's in the 30 for 30. You talk about 30, this.
Yeah, people calling me names and stuff, and I was like, this wasn't like this in high school, you know.
You were in L.A., right, in high school?
I was in L.A., and it wasn't like this in high school, and I was playing in Lynchburg, Virginia, and, you know, I was hearing all these things, you know, and I was like, man, I'm done with baseball. So I just started smoking weed every day down there.
Was it different than L.A. and Lynchburg?
Of course. What do you think?
Wow, but it was that bad where you wanted to quit and you started smoking a lot of pot.
I started smoking a lot of pot, yeah.
Some of the other players support around you that were dealing with the same issues?
They were all young too, you know. We're kind of all young and, you know, trying to find our way in the minor leagues and, you know,
the Mets organization, they were probably having nervous breakdowns when you said, I want to quit. Because everyone knew, we all heard about you before you even made it up to the, you know, to the Mets. That we got this guy, Darryl Strawberry, and he's unbelievable. So they must have been like, oh my God, what is it going to take to make sure this guy doesn't quit?
Yeah, they didn't want me to quit. They said, you know, they asked me to give it another year. And I went to Jackson, Mississippi in AA, and I became the Texas League MVP. I became a baseball player, but I didn't become a man. Mm. To make that clear, people need to understand, you know, who we are and what we do doesn't make you a man.
Right.
You
Mississippi, know? Texas, Lynchburg, could they pick a different place for you to come up, maybe?
Yeah, yeah. Well, they should have.
Well, Kingsport, it's minor league. That's part of it.
They should have picked Cape Cod or Greenwich, Connecticut.
You would think it'd be some great places where you would come through in minor leagues. And minor leagues was not like that. It's different today. You know, they have a lot of beautiful minor league ballparks, but they didn't have them back in the days when I was playing.
And you came right out of high school, right? So you were a young guy.
I came out of high school, and I was 21 when I got to the big leagues. I won Rookie of the Year in 1983, and Doc came right after me. He was 19, and he won Rookie of the Year.
In 84.
In 84.
It was unbelievable, and you guys were connected more by the media, because I learned in the 30 for 30, I did not know. You guys hung out, but not as close as everyone thought you guys were.
Well, that was the presumption of everyone, you know, that we were best friends, and we wasn't. You know, Eric Davis was my best friend, because we grew up together, and we spent a lot of time in the offseason training together, me and him, because we played Little League together. Doc lived in Florida, and they just, you know, people just projected that, you know, they're the best of friends because they wear the Met uniform together and they hang out. You know, we didn't hang out a lot on the road. You know, Doc hung out with a lot of other players. I hung out with, you know, maybe those years I was hanging out with, like, Bobby Ojeda, Ron Darling, guys like that. You know, I didn't really hang out with Doc a lot. You know, he was on a different roads. You know, we're different people, and I think people don't understand that nobody's the same. You know, people always try to, you know, say people are the same, you know, because we came in with this high profile as an athlete, but that we're a different person, and I think people need to hear that. It needs to be clear, and you'll see in the film it's clear that we're two different people.
Absolutely.
And we always have been. I love Doc, you know, but you know what, my friend Gary Green bought this film together. And he brought me and Doc back together. Mm. Now me and Doc have a better relationship.
How did it feel to sit down and talk to him, like just you guys discussing these things?
Well, that's what I'm saying. It brought our relationship, you know, back to a place where, you know, it's healthy again, you know. And it was healthy back then just because we were going different ways, you know. I think a lot of times the media used to say Doc and Daryl, you used to compare them, you know, and... you know, I was really grateful. I was really excited about the fact that when Gary approached me about would I do the film with Doc, I says yes, because I love Doc. You know, if anybody knows what Doc was like and what he meant to the New York Mets in those days when he got on the mound and pitched for us, it was just incredible. It was incredible as a player to sit behind and watch him pitch and perform.
I was telling the younger people around me yesterday, because you were coming in, I'm like, when Doc Gooden pitched, I was a huge Mets fan back then. It was an event. Everyone stopped what they were doing. I mean, if you always watched Doc Gooden pitch, and those were the games you wanted to go to Shea Stadium to see, and you would make sure you watched him pitch on TV no matter what. And then you maybe would tap out for four games, and then until the next time he pitched.
24 wins in one season is insane.
He was, 19 at the time?
He was 20.
20?
Oh my God.
20.
When he won 24 and won the Cy Young.
And then he, on the offseason, he goes back and lives with his mom.
Yeah.
I found that bizarre in the 30 for 30. Yeah, I just assume you guys would have some mansion somewhere that you can...
No, I live with my mom too, you know.
Really?
We wasn't like ready to get out of the house, you know, just because we were in the big leagues.
So, yeah.
You know, we were still kids, you know, I mean...
It's crazy. And
it was like an event when Doc pitched. The nights of him pitching, it was like people coming to the ballpark, they would get there early. And I mean, the ballpark would be just, you know, you could feel the buzz because, you know, it could be one of those games where he's going to punch 14 out or something like that. And, you know, this guy was running up in the corner with the K corner all the time, every time he got two strikes on people and the crowd would be on their feet. You never seen nothing like it. You'll never see nothing like it. There's no comparison. They try to compare these young pitchers that the Mets have. Well, I think they can be like Doc Gooden, Matt Harvey, and these other guys. Nobody was like this guy in his first 2 years of the big leagues. I've never seen nothing like this. And you can stand out there in the outfield. Sometimes you see like, say, Doc, just let him get a hit, man. You know, we're bored out here. You know?
We need some action.
We need some kind of action. But, you rarely seen action when he was on the mound. It was magical, man. It was magical for Met fans and being in Queens and playing at Shea Stadium to come to the ballpark on the nights that he was pitching.
I'm a Yankee fan, so I don't acknowledge the Met days. You guys are Yankees as far as I'm concerned.
Well, you missed that part because the Mets ruled the town.
Yeah, no, I remember.
You know, the Yankees came along a little bit after.
Yeah, Yankees were having a hard time at the 86 Mets.
Steinbrenner wanted to make it hurt, and he started, obviously getting you guys.
He's taking some of the Mets, but yeah.
Well, the 80s were the Mets. The 70s and the 90s, the Yankees had.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
So what do we have now?
I mean, the Mets are a better team right now, I think.
They're both hurting right now. Yeah. They got to get back on track.
But the Mets made the series last year. I mean, the Yankees have been hurting for a couple years now.
Yeah. But then, talking about the 86 Mets, everyone was expecting a few World Series out of you guys.
Well, we should
have. Came close in 88.
We should have had it. We should have had a few World Series. We were animals. You know, we really were. And when I look back on it and reflect on it from time to time, it makes me laugh. You know, because we were so good. But we didn't take care of ourselves like we should have. You know, we partied, we went out, you know, a bunch of amphetamines, poppers, you know, and alcoholics, you know, and but we played baseball, and we should have won more divisions. You know, we came up short. We kept coming up short. You know, we were winning 95 games a year. So wow. Back then you had to win the division. We would have been in the wild card every year if they had wild card, right, but they didn't. So I think a lot of times if we would have, you know, stayed out of bars, stayed out of fights, you know, it probably been a lot different for us.
Well, that's hard to tell young guys living in New York to stay out of the bars and the clubs.
Yeah, but plus we were
good,
man.
That doesn't make it easy. And then the whole league hated you guys. Was that the truth?
Hated us. Mm. They couldn't stand us, you know. They thought we were arrogant, cocky. Loved you. You know, our curtain calls, you know, it's like, who do these guys think they are?
Yeah.
You know,
do you think that brought you closer together, the fact that you guys all knew you were hated?
Well, we loved it. You know, we loved being hated. You know, we went to St. Louis. They called us a bunch of pond scums, you know. They had signs up. And we kind of got off. We kind of got off on that, you know, everywhere we go. You know, we had this little slogan where you're like, we're gonna kick your butt. We're going to drink your alcohol. We're going to screw your women, and we're going to just leave town after that.
Yeah. You know? Leave your town a mess. Yeah. You guys were like rock stars. Can you talk about the Greenies really fast? The whole team was doing some the Greenies back then?
Well, it was a lot of guys, you know, that got involved in amphetamines. You know, amphetamines were part of the game. Just like cocaine came in the 70s, you know, amphetamines came in. Amphetamines always been in the game. And then, like the steroids, drugs has always been in sports, period.
Mm-hmm.
Every sports, you know, people be saying, well, no, I don't do that. You know, drinking alcohol is just as bad, you know, because guys get out in bars and they get into fights because they get drunk, you know, because somebody look at them wrong, you know. Well, that's the kind of guys we were. You know, we had chips on our shoulders because we knew everybody hated us. And, you know, I took Greenies for a long time. I started in 86. We really started taking Greenies every day. And I started depending on them every day. I took them from that point on throughout the rest of my career. I couldn't go without taking them because I got addicted to them.
And the ball just looked a lot bigger.
It looks like a softball.
That's what you were saying in the 30 for 30.
Yeah, it looks like a softball. You know, it looked like a softball coming in. I would just crush it. You know?
you did.
Yeah. So, I mean, that was part of it, you know. It was part of what sports was.
How long are you sober now?
I'm 13 years in.
Oh, wow.
13 years. Yeah. Good for you. Yeah. What was I going to say? Do you remember some times when you were really hungover the next day?
And oh, yeah, yeah. There's a lot of times I played hungover, but I crushed the ball.
How do you deal
with
that? I
take Greenies, you know. I remember a night I went out with one player, and, you know, it was all night, you know. And when we came out of the club here, and it was like 8 o'clock in the morning, we had a day game. Went to his apartment, laid down, went to the ballpark at 10, popped a couple of Greenies, drank some coffee, laid on the trainer's table. First bat, I get up, I hit a bullet in the alley. Yeah, I mean, going and running in, getting a triple slide in third, head's throbbing. The other teammate, he's sitting over there looking. He's a pitcher. He's sitting over there looking with his hat hanging down. He's looking and shaking his head. Can't believe it because he know I just got in.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, I came in to score. He goes, how do you do it? I said, I just do it. You know, this is the way I play.
Can you imagine?
Yeah, I struggle to get to the deli for a bagel. So, I can't imagine hitting a stand-up triple.
No. Get the blood flowing like that, which makes the headache that much worse.
I mean, it became a routine you learn. But you never know that routine like that is going to crash and burn you.
Mm.
And a lot of athletes do crash and burn. And you see more today, younger athletes crashing and burning because they'd be hanging out there partying. And the drugs are different, and more challenging now for them. And once they get addicted to it and get addicted to that lifestyle, you know, because you go to the parties and there's drugs everywhere and you just you fall into it. And before you know it, you can't even think. You can't even play.
Do you remember the moment where you realized it wasn't working for you anymore? Because obviously you could drink all night and you're still, you know, doing your job. But when that finally turned?
There was a lot of times where, well, when the injuries started to come. You know, you started having different type of injuries. You know, I started having back injuries and, you know, started, you know, feeling slow. Wasn't as fast as I was. And, you know, then it just all started to spin out of control, you know, because I went from that. I went from that to smoking crack, and I went from that to shooting dope.
Wow.
You know, sticking needles in my arm. And, you know, because it just goes on and on. It's a nonstop because you get... Your personality and your mind gets addicted to that lifestyle out there, and you get in and you get embedded in, and it's hard to get out. That's why programs are important, you know, to help people, because the programs do really help people.
Yeah, and you've dedicated your life to helping others.
Yeah, exactly.
I have to ask you, sorry, I didn't forgive. Did your dad forgive you?
Right.
We didn't finish the story. You said you laid your head and he did forgive you.
Yes, my dad forgave me, and I, you know, it was an emotional time, and then I led my dad to the Lord.
Oh, okay. He died.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Was that the toughest forgiveness you had to ask for? Was from him?
Well, it wasn't for him, you know, because forgiveness is not for that person. Forgiveness was for me,
right?
You know, because I needed to forgive myself because I'm wrong too. You know, there's no winning and one just saying one person is wrong because we all. You know, we all fall short and we all have a part of playing wrong, too. So I needed to get free to clean up my side of the street. And I think that's what's important. And that's what I tell people that's trying to get well. You have to clean up your side of the street of what you've done, not what everybody else has done to you, because you've done a lot to everybody else. Mm-hmm. And when you can get to that place, then you can accept the fact that forgiveness was for you. And I needed that for myself.
Wow.
I'm curious, when you look at someone like Johnny Manziel, what do you think?
It saddens me, you know, because here's a kid that has all the potential to be good at what he's doing, but he's allowing the wrong people to make the decisions for him, to tell him he doesn't need that, he needs this, and that's the trouble of falling into that life of partying. You know, because you believe that now this is the excitement, the girls, the drugs, the alcohol, I'm hanging out, going to this place, that place, and I'm such and such. You don't have to be. You could be Johnny Manziel sitting at home and be great with all that foolishness that's going on in his life. Because he has the talent to do it. He's already proven that he has it. It's just a matter of, can I stay out of the nightlife? You know, if he can stay out of the nightlife, his life will change.
Yeah, they're saying you got to go. Daryl, this 30 for 30 is
really great.
Yeah, we just scratched the surface. It's a great look back, and what a life you have lived so far.
Yeah.
It's an amazing life, for real, what you've been through and how you've been able to, you know, figure things out. Does it scare you that you would go back?
No, yeah, because I don't play with old things.
Good for you.
You know, you have to learn not to play with old things.
Right.
And too many people play with old things. What are you laughing? You play with old things.
No. Well, you know, so to speak.
It's,
I got you. We'll be here all day talking about that, right?
There's so much to this 30 for 30. It's on tonight. Doc and Daryl premieres tonight at 9 p.m. on ESPN. You're a great guest, too. Say hi to the wife and come back and see us.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate you guys having me. You guys
right
are cool, man.
All right. Daryl Strawberry.
Thanks a lot.
Cool. I want to thank Daryl Strawberry for stopping by. He was great.
Yeah, what a nice guy.
I wish we had more time with him, but he's very busy promoting this Doc and Daryl. The 30 for 30 that's on ESPN tonight, premiering finally for everybody.
Yep.
And Sam Morril said that that was one of his favorite 30 for 30s. And I said... I agree with that, but then I'm thinking every time I see a 30 for 30, it's my favorite. They do such a great job with that
amazing
series.
Even the last one, Believe Land.
That was amazing.
Amazing. They're all killer. Pretty much.
Even a subject that you don't give a shit about.
Right.
They do a good job with it. Which one did you say, the Brothers one?
Once Brothers is probably my all-time favorite 30 for 30, the one about the Yugoslavian basketball team before the Civil War broke out.
Mm.
And it was basically, it's basically about Drazen Petrovic and Vlade Divac. And Vlade Divac, just, he does an amazing job telling the story. It's just so fucking good.
What's the gist of it?
I mean, Croatia and Serbia basically split apart.
Right.
They have this amazing Yugoslavian basketball team. It's like a lot of NBA players, Tony Kukoc, Dino Raja, those two I just mentioned. And they basically give even the USA a run. They lose, but they're the only team that gave the dream team a run for their money, really. And I forget which is which. One's Croatian, one's Serbian, between Drazen and Vlade. And they, once the civil war breaks out, they go from being best friends to never speaking ever again. And
wow.
And then they both end up getting drafted by the NBA. And Vlade is a success on the Showtime Lakers, but Drazen's a better player, but he's a bench warmer because he's playing behind like Clyde Drexler and, you know,
right,
all these great guards on the Blazers. So it's basically their journey, and there's a lot of sad turns, but it's unbelievable.
Oh, that sounds really good. I'll watch that.
That's the one I'm going to watch tonight.
That's my selling point for it.
That's good. I'm in, man. I watched that Lynn Bias one. I think it's isn't that a 30 for 30?
I believe so.
I think, yeah. I got to see that one.
That one I haven't seen.
I think it's called Without Bias.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the best way to live. I mean,
there's one coming out in February that we're all going to like.
Which one?
Mike and the Mad Dog.
Oh.
They're doing a 30 for 30 about them?
They're both doing one, yeah. They're doing a 30 for 30 about the show.
Wow. That'll be very interesting.
I don't think Mike wants to do it, but he's reluctantly taking
it. He doesn't want to do anything.
Yeah, of course not. Well, he's done soon, right?
I miss talking about Mike Francesa on this show. We haven't played a good Mike Francesa clip in a while.
I think there was one last week. He did something last week.
What did he do last week?
I don't remember.
He's the best. But Darryl Strawberry, wow.
He looks great.
He looks solid, right?
Yeah.
Looks like he could still play.
100%.
Yeah, those hands, I'm like, holy shit.
Yeah, beautiful hands.
Big fucking hands.
He was mentioned in The Bad Lieutenant. When fucking Harvey Keitel's having his meltdown, he wants Strawberry to...
Right.
That was the best.
I don't remember that.
You don't remember that?
Yeah.
You don't?
Oh, yeah.
Jay Moore does the whole impression.
Yeah, Jay Moore did that impression many times on this show. If you can find it really fast, from The Bad
Strawberry.
Lieutenant. Yeah. I'm trying to remember the exact lines.
Don't remember it either.
You don't have to get...
Jay Moore, get the movie.
Yeah, just get the actual clip from Bad Lieutenant.
Such an eager boy.
And Doc, I hope he's doing well. I would assume they would have want those two guys to do press together.
Shoots
today.
Radio.
Yeah.
Shoots Radio might be it.
All right, let's play this.
Under his mind out, it's now 2-0. Daniel's in a game situation here. If he can work his way aboard, then the load falls.
Here's Jimmy Kennedy.
Cheryl Strawberry, as he has a chance to play hero once again for the Dodgers, but it's up to Daniels at this point. From the stretch, the 2-0 pitch, ball three.
Good eyes. Drinking,
driving, listening to the game.
Put the belt around his neck and starts jerking off.
It should be called The Great Lieutenant.
All right.
Good move. Take the pitch.
That's the automatic.
Eyes.
3-1.
Come on, Daniel. Eyes.
2-1 out. Here's the 3-1 pitch. Ground ball to short. Could be two. Left to second for one. Relay to first. It's a double play.
You cocksucker! You fucking miserable fucking cocksucker!
Shoot his radio.
Turns on his siren. Peels out of there.
Piece of fucking shit! You fucking nigga! Fucking cocksucker!
I love that he just shoots the radio. I agree.
Oh, you turn it off.
Oh, he's
trying. You fucking piece of shit! Where is he going?
Yeah.
Oh my God! Yeah, the scene with Christ—that's such a good movie.
It's a wonderful movie. That's not the speech about Darryl Strawberry though. But whatever.
What a hard,
still a great scene.
What a hard role to do that is.
Yeah,
you got a camera guy there. They're pulling your car. He's gonna be doing coke. And,
What movie is that?
Bad Lieutenant with Harvey Keitel. Don't watch the Nick Cage one. Watch the Harvey Keitel.
The Nick Cage one has funny moments though, but it's you know. It's not a great movie, but Nick Cage. I want to see Nick Cage break down a lot.
Family Man's his best movie, I think.
Really?
It's really good.
I don't know it.
Oh, I like Beauty in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Did you see, speaking of addictions, you see President Bush at the memorial dancing? So people are wondering that he might be back on the sauce after 30 years.
He voted.
Did you see this?
No.
Oh, my God. Everyone got so uncomfortable. At the he started just dancing to the battle hymn of the Republic. Yeah. It's like a... It's a somber moment, and he's just loving this.
Oh, my God.
He's swaying like everyone else is in mourning. It gets better. Watch this.
Oh, no. Michelle Obama's looking at her looking at him like, what the fuck are you doing?
Oh, my God. He's trying to get her to sing along with him.
Oh, my God.
He's smiling and moving, and Laura Bush is looking at him like, ugh. She's giving him that look like, you stop it.
Oh, he's been drinking oil, it looks
he's
like.
He's smiling. Oh, my God, George.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah, he's probably getting into the song.
He's the only one in the room that's really feeling it, but it's just not the proper time.
Yes. I always smile during that song, though. It's understandable.
Yeah, there's some sadness in that room, and he's like, oh, I like this one.
He's Cop's Widow's like, is that guy dancing during my husband's funeral? Does the ex-president show up and decide to dance?
And smile?
We lost 5 cops. Could you not swing your arms so gleefully?
Exactly. Sir, could you not do-si-do? We're throwing fucking dirt on a coffin.
Yeah, the smile is the best part. He's like so happy, and everyone else is like, what
Michelle
are you doing?
Obama's face is like, yeah,
she's like,
fuck?
What the fuck? I'm holding hands with the ex-president. Honey, your predecessor is having a meltdown.
Yeah. And then Laura Bush gives him some shade, as they like to say.
That's just not a good thing to do in that moment.
No.
Yeah. Oh, you know what it was? He was probably hunting for a Pokemon.
He looks like he's playing Red Rover. That's definitely bizarre, man.
Yeah, that was a really uncomfortable moment.
That was...
I wonder what he thinks about when he sees that.
He probably is just thinking about the song. No, he's thinking about the song, and he's in church. He's not thinking about the dead cops. In that moment, he's just in church singing Glory Hallelujah.
Yeah, he had to be told why that was wrong.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
I don't think he feels like he was being disrespectful or anything.
No.
He was just feeling it, and is kind of bothered that no one else in the room was feeling it with him. They're all staring at him.
They're like, what is he doing? Why are you dancing, sir? This is Obama won't look at him.
It kind of makes you miss him a little.
Yeah.
I wish you did the Ricky Gervais dance right there.
Yeah. I mix flash dance with MC Hammer shit.
Could you go back to it? It gets better and better the more
it's
you see it.
It's so uncomfortable.
Because watch, everyone just starts staring. Look, Joe Biden's like, what the fuck is he doing?
That's Biden.
That's Biden holding Laura Bush's hand, who's holding the ex-president's hand, who's holding Michelle Obama's hand. Barack is trying to smile a little bit with it.
He's like, he's lost his mind. The little hand thing, then. Smiling. 5 coffins. He can't get a smile off his dumb face. It's the wrong time to be fucking partying up.
He bumps his wife.
Yeah.
And does that gesture like, isn't this great?
Yeah. Why is everybody mad? I was just doing the electric slide. I'm supposed to do that in front of an open casket, sir.
But the whole row of people are all just looking at him like, what is this idiot doing?
They can't believe he's doing it.
Yeah.
Bush, Obama, and Biden with their wives.
Yeah.
And I'm guessing high up police officials.
Oh, the chief of police
over freshly dead officers.
Right.
And he's,
what an idiot.
Yeah.
He's just having a good old time.
Yeah. It's electric. What did he say?
The awareness when he realizes, oh, this is one of those songs I really like, and he can't help himself.
Glory, glory. I mean, he's probably just used to getting pumped up during that song. Yeah. The church, the Lord, truth, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe he fucks to it with his wife, and he was just kind of feeling
it. Back into it. Yeah, they probably do. Put your face down on a pillow.
But she gave him a look like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah, I bet if Heather. Yeah,
I could see them banging to that.
Yeah, to that one? Patriotic songs playing?
Joe Biden can't. For Joe Biden to fucking give you the cold shoulder during an uncomfortable moment, you know how bad you have to be doing for Biden to go, this is uncomfortable.
He's had his moments over the years, certainly.
Yeah.
Mr. Biden.
Well, people thought back on 9/11, remember that famous footage of him standing on top of the pile of rubble?
Yeah.
And there was that one moment where he had the helmet on, and then he put it on the ground and he head spun. People were like, that's uncomfortable. Long way to go. He's laying down cardboard. board. Oh no, he's gonna break dance. Thanks.
We tweeted out the video, but I'm sure most of you have seen that one before.
I had not seen it.
Okay.
I like to watch everything live on the radio.
Yeah, make it all
keeps it all snappy.
Yes. Bernie Sanders supporters planning a fart in. Why is this a story?
A what?
They're going to do a fart in at the national convention to protest things.
Is that really, what that's considered?
That
now?
Really
good.
Stink.
You can't interfere with my political statements in this studio anymore. I mean,
or are you going to go to human resources?
That's right.
In Philly.
And yeah, they're in Philly, and the Republicans are up there in Cleveland. Isn't it time? Isn't it, what, next week it starts finally? The conventions? So. I believe
yeah.
so, right?
Yeah, I think this weekend.
And then you got Donald Trump. He's going to announce his running mate tomorrow at 11 a.m. here in New York City. Everyone's saying it's going to be that Pence guy. Yeah, whatever. He's from
Indiana. Yeah, a pocket full of him.
I know Newt Gingrich is. I know Newt Gingrich seems to be lobbying for it.
He that fucking douchebag. He everyone hates Newt Gingrich.
Yeah,
everyone hates him.
Yeah, I don't know who likes him.
Trump, you already have the Republicans, dumb Trump. You don't need to get the fucking Republicans. Stop trying to be a slave to that conservative side of the party. What do you think they're going to do? Vote for Hillary? Mm. You have them.
Yeah, those are the ones you definitely got. Right?
Get a more liberal,
like a Native American.
Or, you know, anybody who's not Newt Gingrich.
More of a moderate
Native American. Could help him with the casinos, maybe.
Yeah,
maybe some a little ethnic in there, a little bit.
But Jesus, fucking Newt Gingrich.
It's between Newt, this Pence guy that I don't know much about, and then you got Christie sort of on the short list still.
I'd hate to work for Pence.
Oh, Christie must be so bummed. His tongue must be brown from.
No kidding.
He has just been tonguing Trump's ass for months.
I'd hate to work for Pence because then people would say he works under Pence. Under Pence.
There's Newt, huh?
Oh, Travis, comment?
I'm glad you went back to it.
Oh, nice. Wow. So you're not no to Newt Gingrich?
Well, he's wearing a Google thing.
Oh, yeah.
Why would you let someone take a picture like that? It's a man from space.
Yeah, that's your political news, I guess. That's all we got today on that.
Yeah. Come on, Trump. Stop it, this shit.
Kind of tired of the whole thing.
Yeah.
Just tell us who we got.
Yeah.
Let's just get it over with. Move the new guy in there. All right. Oh, there was something else in there. I'm trying to remember. Nah, not the tenors. Oh, the Pokemon.
What's the vagina massage too?
Oh, you want to do that?
Yeah,
we could do that. Did we print up that story? We have that.
Yeah.
Huh?
I have it on.
Fucking put my thumbs in that vulva.
Want to thank somebody on the old Twitter said, "Ope, you gotta check this out. Here's what happens during a totally legal $330 vagina massage."
Oh, the yoni.
From deep tissue to hot stone, there isn't much the massage industry has not offered. But the latest craze is for the most intimate treatment yet. The yoni.
No, yoni.
Yoni, yoni. The yoni massage.
Yoni's the great, great singer.
I know. That's why I got tricked, because I went and saw Yoni once. The yoni massage is exclusively for women and focuses on ladies' private parts. Wow.
Wow. You see, you see a cut to it, and someone's dipping their fist in lard like Caligula.
What do you get for $330? Here's what happened when Bleb put her inhibitions aside to give the yoni massage a try. Name a type of massage, and the chances are I've tried it. For me, there's nothing better than lying semi-comatose on a kitten-soft bed while a stranger pummels the giant knots from my back. I was even once held upside down by a yogi in India and massaged by his feet.
That sounds terrible. To be held upside down by a yogi in India with your face close to the ground while his dirty feet are on you.
Yeah,
what a lousy massage that must have been.
What?
Ron's here. Yeah.
I don't like that hot stone. That thing always seemed like a scam.
The hot stone, they always...
They're pretty relaxing.
They fall off my back and then it takes you out of the moment because they clunk to the floor.
Yeah. Yeah, he's putting hot rocks on your back.
Right.
Oh, he's coming. Oh.
Paul, you have wonderful timing. In the middle, he hands me a note. You want him in right now? I'm okay. What's up, buddy?
The Welcome. Yoni. Hi, Ron.
How are you, Ron?
How are you?
What's up, Ron?
How are you, buddy?
What's up, man? Opie, how are you?
We're just doing a story. There's a vaginal massage that we're covering.
Yeah.
It's new, Ron.
Huh?
Glad I could jump in.
It's a... The post, where were we? I like, all right, we got a vagina massage. It costs $330.
Okay.
And this is legit shit.
I mean, I'll do it for half the price until that joke's been made.
No, none of us
did. Yeah. We just started.
No, we just sat here like comedians going, oh, that's an interesting piece of news. None of us said a funny thing yet.
We're only one paragraph in, though. Yeah. We got to give ourselves a little credit here. Where were we? So this is, there's a lady. She's tried all sorts of massages, including the one where they held her upside down in India while the guy massaged her with his feet. Okay. I thought that was a pretty intimate experience until I heard about the yoni massage. I must admit, I was curious and confused all at once, but my overriding feeling was I had to give it a try. Yoni is the Sanskrit word for vagina and means sacred space.
Oh, enough with over. I love the vagina, but it's not a sacred space.
Yeah. It's not a handicapped spot, you know?
Yeah.
The idea of the massage is to release physical and emotional blockages. Oh, yeah. And free sexual energy to enable the recipient to become more in tune with her body.
I love how they doll up making someone come.
Right.
You're in touch with your energy. I'm coming in your hand.
But there's someone with brilliance out there. He found a way. It's a he, and he realized I could figure out how to massage vaginas all day and make this sound legit.
I mean, I do that. I ladies are into what I'm doing. That's how I start massage at the back. I end in the vagina. That's my general massage technique.
Well, do you turn them over or do you work it in from the back? The best is when you're massaging the back of the thighs and you do this little like when that moment comes where you just hit her legs like this and she opens them up.
Some women experience an orgasm, but that isn't the goal.
No, why would it be when you're playing with a vagina?
Yeah, these are tramps, probably.
What else is it good for?
I'm doing it freelance, I feel like, and it's okay.
You could be making money off this.
When I saw a $330 massage, I just assumed the guy would be like a better listener or something that would play a role.
I don't want to feel somebody's vagina for an hour. I don't want to do it.
I do.
An hour?
For an hour? I don't know. Yeah. I might get sick of it after an hour.
Yeah, I feel like there's just more and more to learn.
All right, let's see. Let's get into this a little more. Not the goal to have an orgasm. Having never been comfortable with my own nudity, it was with some trepidation that I booked in a session with a London agency that specializes in sensual massage. All of its masseurs are women, and the one assigned to me was 28-year-old yoni expert Lisa.
A yoni expert.
She's an expert.
Yeah.
Lisa's an expert at this.
Yeah, she really knows her way around a cunt.
Before the main event takes place, she tells me an ordinary massage is about releasing the muscles. A sensual massage like yoni is about awakening the body and seeing what's there to enable pleasure. Donning her white overcoat and black trousers.
What? Oh, that's the worst. They're trying to dress like it's like a legit spa massage.
Like the Wyatt Earp of vagina.
I think at this point it's okay to ditch the white overcoat if you're rubbing vaginas for a living. Lisa sets about creating the right ambience for my massage, which involved dimming the lights, lighting aromatic.
Sound it out.
Oh my God.
You got it.
Thank you.
It's aromatic.
Oh, fuck. Wow. My brain exploded there. We began with an undressing ceremony.
You nailed that word.
You know what, Ron? You're going to fit you right in. I've only known you for 2 minutes. We're going to have a long, nice relationship. I stand with my eyes closed, feeling awkward as Lisa lifts off my baggy T-shirt and peels down my underwear. Just let that sink in for a second, right? While breathing heavily on my neck. This is legit?
Well, it's just a sensual massage.
It's strange being undressed by a woman the last time. Yeah, but you would get in trouble for it.
It sounds like it's
they're saying this is legit.
Tantric. When you go for a tantric massage, they'll do stuff like this. Like the whole body to body. You know, it's like a regular massage that gets dirty is different than this.
I don't know.
So you're going there knowing there's going to be sensual touching here, whereas a regular massage sometimes it's just a gamble.
What do you mean by the gamble?
You just hope they speak broken English.
It's a strange. It's strange being undressed by a woman. The last time that happened was when my best friend put me to bed after I overdid it on a drunken night out.
Ooh, I want
to
hear that story.
Lisa starts by massaging my feet, rubbing every toe between her fingers with aromatherapy oils. I got that one right. So far, so ordinary. She works her way up the back of my legs, and I start to feel blissfully relaxed when suddenly I feel a hand slip between my buttocks.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it. You work at the back of the leg.
Yeah.
I like to feel a little bit of butt.
Okay, now this doesn't feel so ordinary. Lisa proceeds to slide her palms up and down the backs of my thighs, gradually edging towards the gap between my legs.
Mm. This is well written.
I mean, I feel like this is just a good way to get porn into the New York Post. I like it.
Yeah, it's very
whatever they want to do.
Yeah, usually we just highlight the, you know, some parts of the article, but we're reading every word of this one. I squirm a little, but she tells me to breathe deeply and focus on the feeling, and it works. By the time she's moved her hands to the front of my crotch, I'm so relaxed she could have massaged me with a Brillo pad and I wouldn't have noticed.
Mm. Why'd they have to throw that into the story?
I don't know.
Why'd you depict things that could have been on your vagina that ruined it?
She could have shoved a brick in my twat.
It's basically just the importance of a foreplay. You
I know, but she had to unsexy it with the Brillo pad.
Right.
She could have massaged me with a child's face.
Right.
Oh. Almighty.
I was initially apprehensive about letting a woman touch me down there, but my inhibitions evaporate the more the massage progresses. Even when Lisa asked me to turn over and works her hands down from my belly to my privates, I feel caressed rather than sexed up.
Mm.
None of it feels intrusive at all.
Well, it's because you want to do it for that. Of course not. If you go there knowing that's what you're getting, it won't. But I know a lot of girls have gotten massages, and they say a guy kind of got like a little creepy, and it's uncomfortable. But if you go there for a woman to
do
that.
Even if you didn't know it and she just started finger blasting you, you wouldn't like it.
No,
maybe you would like it.
No,
thank you.
There has to be a little bit of a lead up to it. I like a lead up too. I don't like when someone, I've gotten dirty where a girl just does it.
Right.
I love to like, well, is it going to happen? Is it not going to happen? Almost feels seductive.
And, that give and take, that rubber band of tension.
Yeah, that dance.
Mm-hmm. Have you gotten a happy ending massage?
No, never.
It's nice.
Not in paid for or for free. I need to get better ladies in my life.
Yeah.
She softly presses a cupped palm onto my nethers and makes circular motions to get the blood flowing.
Cupped palm?
Using her hands, fingers, and even her breath to warm, soothe, and knead.
Oh, she's breathing.
I mean, the headline here is that this is legal. That's why this is a story today. I'm surprised to find that instead of becoming aroused, I just feel tingly and blissful all over. When Lisa announces my time is up, I feel a combination of relief and disappointment.
Because you're probably horny. You're worked up.
Yeah, at that point, it's.
Yeah, this sounds like a gateway to lesbianism, I feel like, a little bit.
Yeah.
You know? I'm start trapping them.
Relief because it hasn't been as embarrassing as I'd imagined, but disappointment that the lightheaded giddiness and tingly feeling is now subsiding. Wow.
A yoni. Yeah, I like that they call it a yoni. That means a girl's done yoga. She's usually a yoga girl, and when they start saying yoni, you're like, something fucking hot about that.
Mm-hmm. I agree. It's wicked. You feel like anal's a definite possibility.
Yeah.
You just feel like they're just going to be into it sexually if they use the word yoni. I agree with you very much.
It's a good word.
Well, now let's look up the guy who invented the yoni, because he should win an award.
Yeah, but he's a real...
He does get one every time when someone comes in. Well, that was a woman, though.
Doing that particular yoni massage, but you got to assume this was invented by a guy, don't you?
I did not know what this was. I knew it only as a Jewish name.
Yeah, I like that. Oh. But I like you assume that the name for a vagina was invented by a man. It was probably a lady.
This particular massage.
Oh, the massage.
The technique, the yoni technique. You got to think some guys like, how do I figure out how to touch women's vagina? Vaginas all day.
Do they touch inside? Did it say that?
They won't say it, but they probably, if she's using her breath on it,
you'll
just lean over and look at it. You know, it's not a fucking mirror.
Yeah.
You gotta think.
Oh, I like that the yoni hand symbol is the reverse diamond cutter.
See, they got it all figured out. If you find anything in there, Iraq, let us know.
No, but it's very old. Like, there's no one person that they're giving credit. They're crediting it mostly to the Indian culture and religion.
I remember one woman, the first time I heard Yoni was a girl who was massaging me, a legit massage. And she was, this is 2003, and she was, she straddled, I asked her, she had shorts on and a nice little plump butt, and I asked her to straddle, like I was to look up so I could look up her shorts a little while she massaged me, and her vagina, her pussy was so big, like so, it was by far the biggest one I'd ever seen, like I literally lost my breath.
Was it big in a like she had a lot of kids or just
no,
just
a meaty?
Gotcha. Okay.
She called it a yoni. Like she was into.
She called it a yoni.
Yoni.
This is hilarious. Yoni. This is your clean massage.
No. Well, this guy said it was getting sensual.
Oh, I thought you said it was a legitimate one.
No, but she worked me into such a frenzy. I remember I was going to Dallas the next morning, and I gave her $600. This is 2003, and I think I just got to jerk off maybe. She worked me so good. I knew her for years. Mm. And she wasn't so greedy. Like, she would always ask for more. She literally, I got a lot of sensual massages from her over the years. And she would always, like you said, the rubber band tension. I would have at one point signed over my apartment to her. If she knew how to work me just a little bit as far as pretending she enjoyed coming over, like as opposed to like, you know, how much more, she would always try to get more, and then I was like, fuck this, you know, it's not worth that much. We're not having sex.
She had you.
She did.
She didn't realize how much she had you.
She had me in a way that, like, she got a lot out of me over the years, which was fine. She gave me great massage, but she literally could have had everything. I would right now be talking about that bitch who made me destitute. She just had a little bit of ability to fucking work it.
Mm.
Oh, gosh, she's a good pussy.
There's some big vaginas out there.
It was awesome. I'll never forget that blue shorts and then looking up and just seeing it and going, oh my, I didn't know how to handle.
That was like an eclipse. That was like seeing God for you.
It was really an altering experience.
Was it intimidating?
No.
No.
He wanted to go toward it. It was like a light.
There wasn't even a pause between the question and the answer there.
Someone opens a bank vault and you see gold bars. You don't go, oh, let me get away from that.
If I see some are intimidating, I feel
what
like.
What makes it intimidating?
Just some of them look like they know more than you do.
They're professionals. Like they've played in the majors.
Yeah.
And you're still coming up.
Yeah.
You're in like AA ball.
Yeah, some of them look like a real, they got the whole dime in the outfield, everything. Look like he's trying to hand you something. You ever seen that kind of vagina? Look like he's trying to hand you something.
Is it meaty?
Yeah.
I like that.
That's the kind Jimmy likes. That.
Yeah.
Jimmy likes to hand you something.
Yeah.
Because I just feel like it's too...
Jimmy likes it to be very disorganized.
Yeah, it looks like he's handing you two pieces of olive loaf.
Jimmy enjoys it.
Looks like a sandwich at Catch's Deli.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, all that. Jimmy's that's Jimmy's thing.
Yeah.
So we got a guy that thinks the Minnesota shooting is a hoax.
Classic.
You want to bring it on?
Sure. I'm guessing it's... I don't know what the motive is. I'd be interested to hear. Hello.
Who is it? Justin, what's up, buddy?
Hello. Let me just start that I'm a humongous fan, and this is like winning a little lot of scratch ticket getting on the air with you guys.
Okay. Oh, you thought that was gonna get a reaction?
No. My phone's horrendous, so I can't tell if it's coming through or if it's gonna be a drop call. I'll just get to the point of it. So I saw the Minnesota video, and coming from a background of being into emergency medicine and being a medical professional for many years, it was very strange to me that it alleged that she had a child in the back, and yet there was multiple gunshots. The child isn't crying whatsoever. You can almost, at the beginning, not even see the child because she's so calm and collected. The woman who initially had the shots go off and the boyfriend who's alert and oriented and he's breathing and his respirations are... within a normal limit pattern, and then all of a sudden he dies within a minute or two later. I mean, decompensated shock that quick, it's not really that likely. It just seems a little irregular, not to mention you never see the cop's face, not to mention that there doesn't seem to be any smoke in the car, and then she doesn't even have a reaction to the gunshots, and she doesn't even have any coping mechanism to help the guy.
Let me ask you a question. Hold on. Since we have the names of the real people, and we have the real officer and the real... department and the real guy, the first hour maybe you could say it's a hoax, but well, how many people do you think are in on this?
I don't know, and I'm saying it along the line of a hoax because it just seemed a little fishy. It didn't seem And I'm only going by what I've seen from many, many scenarios of being the first person, first responder to somebody who's having such a horrific trauma happen. It just didn't really sit right with me as far as my experience and how someone normally reacts. That's what I was kind of going.
Where do you stand on the Holocaust?
Are you asking me?
No.
Because he has a lot to say about it. He's been waiting for his opportunity.
Were the children enough for you?
It just didn't, and then she has the video where she's handcuffed, yet she still has her phone, and she's able to operate the phone in the back of a cop car.
I think it all happened like we saw it, but it does creep me out how calm she was able to be during that situation. Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I understand.
But I don't believe a second it's a hoax. There would be too many people that would have to be in on it.
Yeah, I don't think that cops shooting black people has never been a hoax. That just happens for a long, long time. It's just now on camera.
Have you ever had an uncomfortable encounter with the cops?
I don't know. Not necessarily uncomfortable. I just never had a good one. I grew up in Chicago, and so it's always whenever we need them, they were not there. And whenever I was just trying to go about my business, then they were decided to show up. So I never really had any positive ones, but I never had one where I personally feared for my life.
So it was just annoying.
Yeah, it was just like you don't really do much. It's just, it's always just felt like, there's just another gang that, Bloods and Crips and cops.
What part of Chicago were you in? The
South Side.
Where all the shootings are happening?
Yeah, now it's the West Side. Now it's more because they shut down like the projects on the South Side and everybody over
there. Is Cabrini Green gone?
Yes. Now it's a building complex.
But when you were there, South Side was pretty bad?
Yeah, that's when it was it was the worst.
And then they moved it over to the West Side where it's really bad?
Yes, sir.
How are they going to take care of that situation up there?
I don't know. It's a corrupt city. Yeah. So it's been since it's a city that the mob ran. So it's not like it's new news. None of this is new news. That's why it bores me more than anything. And everybody's like up in arms and things. It's just like it's not new. It's old news.
Right.
It's just now people are watching it on Facebook and Instagram. It's just like, well, I'm glad. To me, go ahead and let white people get upset because I'm sick of being upset about it myself.
Yeah.
There's a lady doing something about that. One lady has that sign.
Yeah, she's a good woman.
We had the story earlier. We think she's just mentally ill. She was walking around Chicago with us. What was the sign again?
Black America, I'm sorry.
Black America, I'm sorry. Thank you, Ron. Thank you for laughing at that.
It's a great
Thank
lie.
You.
And then well done, well put together. The letters are spaced appropriately.
And then she got the attention she was hoping to get because we really believe there's a little me happening here.
Well, sure. She said, I'm sorry.
And then she had no substance, though, because then they asked her, and it was very vague and just.
Yeah, yeah.
It seems more mental illness than anything happening with this, this one.
You just gotta look at what year it is. It's an election year, it's a year of separation, and that's pretty much the whole thing. It's like, so you got women feel separated because they feel like white men are trying to control their bodies. You got white men being like, I'm just a regular dude, and I just like football, and I don't like gay stuff. And that's okay, too.
Who says that?
Theo. Oh.
I don't know about Theo wandered into someone's apartment yesterday just to get a haircut.
I've had some moments, man. I've been through some things, but I think it's all coming full circle.
Guy had a funny eye, and but gave him a wonderful haircut, I gotta tell you.
The back looks nice, too.
I almost want to go to that guy and get that same haircut, but I don't know if I'm brave enough to go into some guy's apartment.
Hugo. That's his name.
His name was Hugo.
Yeah.
I like it.
Colombian.
Continue there, Ron. I apologize.
Well, it's just, again, it's just separation tactics when we're all like the same, we all just want to live and have houses and have sex, and then we don't want to die or get shot by people. That's it. Right. No matter what color you are.
Justin, you good?
I'm good here, yeah. Just enjoying the show. Take care, guys. I hope you have a wonderful week.
I'm sorry we didn't go with the hoax thing. I just don't believe it for a second.
No, I get where you're coming from. And to be honest, when I first saw it, I didn't even realize that it came to as far as what department it was and such. So that's kind of news to me. But it just something seems odd about it. And I think it's an issue with government and media control and not really so much racism. They're making the racism.
It can be everything. It doesn't have to be one or two. It can be a little bit of everything.
Yeah. There's certainly agendas.
That's why they call it racism and not race wasm. Ooh. Pretty good.
Still happening.
Point stuff, Jim.
All right, gentlemen. I got
point.
All right, sir. All right, buddy.
Go.
Thank you. John in New York. Go ahead, buddy.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey. Hello.
Just a thought about the Black Lives Matter and the cops killing. I know it's crazy, but what if black people just behaved?
Do you think that? Yeah. Do you think that's the only problem, John?
Well, I mean, you know, when someone says that that's a bad neighborhood, what does that mean, actually? Someone tell me.
I mean, you didn't really set it up well. We don't.
No, it's not a joke. I'm asking. Someone says, don't go there. That's a bad neighborhood. What does it mean?
It probably means there's a lot of crime in that area, sir.
It's just crime, right?
Yes.
No, John, said,
oh, you're saying that you think because it's a black neighborhood.
Right.
Oh, but yeah, but there's also there's plenty of other.
No one goes into a white neighborhood. You never heard someone say that's a bad neighborhood.
Oh, I lived in some shitty white neighborhoods.
Yeah.
I believe you call them trailer parks. And those are shitty white neighborhoods full of people who sell meth and Oxycontin. So I kind of think you're full of shit on this one.
That's down south. That's not in New York.
Oh, okay, well, I didn't know we had to do it regionally for you. I didn't know we were breaking it down region by region.
I'm just trying to help you.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. So just behave and never want to be.
You solved it. Good job. Well done.
Yeah, that's silly, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, John. There he goes.
He sounded like a sheriff in a fucked up racism.
Yeah.
He's not going to wear that sign.
Seems to be a bit more complicated than that. No, Ron.
Yeah, I mean, it just seems super weird to have a bunch of people going like, hey, black people, it's your fault you get shot. You know, no one never says that about anybody, about any type of crime like that. They don't go, what did you do to get shot? Or what did you do to get raped? It's like, you know, it's like you don't put that problem on the people who's having that issue happen to them. It's right. Not their problem.
If you're robbing a bank, behave. But if you're driving with a broken taillight, you know,
just chill.
Yeah,
have fun.
Just don't consider that you have the rights of every other individual. You know, maybe that's the issue.
Yeah.
One of the strong arguments on that side is if, you know, you're pulled over by a cop, you're supposed to comply and do everything the police officer tells you to do. And a lot of people fighting, you know, this battle from that side will say all you have to do is listen and you know, do what he says, and then you will not be shot and killed.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of that?
I mean, I think that's the difference. That's white privilege that people don't understand, because I've seen it, because I lived in Oregon. And so I've seen a white person get pulled over and then get out of their car of their own accord and go over and talk to the police officer. And I was like, oh, no, I would never do that because I would be dead. And that's the reality that I live with. I don't go like, oh, okay, hello, sir. Like, oh, yeah, you know, I made a mistake. Here's all my information. When they come at me, in my experience, it's always keep your hands on your wheel at 10 and 2, and they're going to yell at me, and I better respond in a measured tone. And that's my life.
Did your parents teach you to really, you know, as the caller said, behave in those situations, like make sure you're alert and doing exactly everything they tell you to do?
Yeah. Yeah. Always. I mean, and again, it's just based off of, and I think when you look at a lot of, black children and stuff, that's where they get hit. That's where there's a more discipline in that regard, because there's always this thing of like, oh, if you step out of line, I'm going to hit you. If you step out of line in public, they're going to shoot you. And so I better make sure you know not to do that.
Right. There's also, you have to say too, though, there's also, you know, black guys are not always polite when they get pulled over. I've been with Keith Robinson when we got pulled over.
Oh, yeah.
And it was not good.
People like to push it. But mostly, usually, if I'm with a white girl, then they're like, fuck the police. Da, da, da. And I'm like, you better calm down. Yeah. You know, they're not going to be mad at you. They're going to be mad at me.
I told Keith to shut up because I was driving.
What did he do?
Oh, he's just being Keith.
Really?
Yeah, Keith was
a little loud, a little boisterous.
What? You know? I'm like, shut up, dude. You're going to get me a ticket. Like, I know that you have past resentments, Keith's from Philly. So you've had a lot of bad experiences. I'm sure a lot were not your fault. I'm sure some were. But you can't say, you know, but having witnessed that and just when the guy came over, and he wasn't a dick. He just, you know, asked what we were doing.
Yeah.
And I knew it was annoying. But Keith reacted as if it was a guy in Philly. Do you know what I mean? He wasn't reacting appropriately to the way this guy was acting.
Yeah. I mean, I think you basically hit the nail on the head in general, is that most people, cops or otherwise, are offering off of past resentments and stereotypes. They're not taking it as each individual situation. Right. And that's why he got shot.
Sure.
Because that guy came in nervous already.
Right.
You know?
Right.
He was already expecting trouble.
Right.
You know? You gotta learn how to just move on.
It's like the definition of prejudice, you know,
exactly.
You're prejudging the situation.
But you also learn from things, too. Like, where is it prejudice, like, whether you're a cop or it's because of race or religion? And then where is it, okay, well, I have to learn. You know, it's almost like Americans don't go to Pakistan. No one goes to Karachi. And you can't tell Americans, we should go to Karachi because you can't judge a book by its cover.
Mm-hmm.
No, we understand that's terrible.
Well, here's also a thing that I found out because I was just in Europe. Most Europeans don't want to come here because they think we're Karachi, you know? And how weird is that? How weird is that they're like, no, I can't come to America because I'll get shot.
Right.
Yeah. You know?
Because the gun culture?
And that's from Germans.
Yeah. Right. I think it's safe to say we at that moment when a cop pulls you over, we all dislike cops, right? Because you're being pulled over. Or that particular cop, I should say it that way. And none of us think it's a pleasant experience. You really want to just act out and then say something to the cop, right?
Usually. I mean, I mostly just want to get back on my day.
Yeah. But it's tough not to. I understand that part of it, too. You really just want to say something. Like, what the fuck? Why are you pulling me over?
Well, yeah. There are a bunch of middle managers, you know? It's like, if not the boss at your job, but the middle manager at your job just stops you in the middle of your day and is like, what's going on? What are your reports you're doing? It's like, you're not even the fucking boss, dude.
Right.
You
know?
You work for the boss.
Exactly.
We both work for the boss.
Those worms. Yeah. We could all relate to those worms.
I get what he's saying. I mean, like, I've talked to cops in a way that a black person can. It's not fair. I mean, I was smoking a joint in the street once on like Second Avenue, and I was with some friends, and a cop car, I guess someone saw me rolling a joint in their doorstep, and a cop car came over, and he was like, what are you guys doing? And I saw him coming, so I just threw the bag in the bushes, took out a cigarette, and I was like, I'm having a cigarette, I can't have a cigarette. And he was like, oh, I'm sorry. Mm. And that was it.
You say he was sorry?
Yeah.
He apologized.
Yeah, that's a different scenario. Yeah. Probably
dream.
Black people deal with.
I've never had that experience.
Yeah.
Now the phones are really starting to ring.
They got a black guy in there.
This is where we solve it.
And this is stereotypical. We weren't. It just happened, Ron. I'm sorry. I want to get to know you, and next thing you know, we're doing. I know, but all right, whatever. Hopefully, we'll get into other things with Ron. Luke, go ahead, buddy.
Yo, all right, I'm in St. Paul where that last shooting went down.
Okay.
How's it going, guys?
Yeah, no, believe it or not, we're just listening
in these calls.
Yeah, we're listening to you, buddy. Go ahead.
All right. So my theory is these murders are, I call them murders because they are, but they're so avoidable, right? Most of these guys resist. And I'm not justifying these guys getting shot, but if they didn't resist, this would not happen. Now, the one in St. Paul is kind of the exception to most of these cases, but if this guy kept his hands on the steering wheel, probably would have been avoided. He did not resist by any means, but most of these other cats did. And if you're telling me any different that these guys stopped resisting, put their hands up, did what they were told to do, they would still be alive today. And most of these cops are coming up with a heightened sense of awareness because they're dealing with a black person. Sad. But, I mean, it's not racist, but...
It's not? Are you sure? Because white people resist arrest all the time. There aren't many viral videos of white people getting shot.
One of your non-racist points were they're dealing with a black person.
But that is
racist. You're assuming a lot that, you know, and he's dealing with a black person, so obviously it's going to be very different than any other experience that he's going to have that day. Go ahead. Most cops, right? Yes.
Most black people and Hispanic people, they have a higher risk of getting shot by police. Now, I'd like to hear the other side of that coin. how many people or how many blacks and Hispanics have killed cops and how many white people have killed cops. I'm sure that it's probably a lot more blacks and Hispanics that have shot cops or killed cops. I mean, that's just the sad truth. And they go into
Well, you know, it's I'm not a cop and I'm not black, but I've talked to enough black guys. This is why I asked you that question, because enough black guys from all walks of life and all have had very similar experiences. And I've talked to enough cops from different places and guys who don't know each other who are independent of each other, and a lot of their experiences have been the same too. Like, a lot of them have said that a lot of the altercations they've had have come from black guys resisting, and a lot of black guys I know have said, I got stopped for nothing. So it's like both sides are saying things independently of each other that are similar.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it's like, not they didn't all talk it over and lie on either side.
Yeah.
Exactly. There's two sides of the coin. I'm not justifying.
Wait, I never heard that before.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not justifying it, but these are avoidable.
Not justifying it, but I don't really give a shit.
All right, Luke. I want to give someone else a chance here. We're going to go to Sacramento and talk to Alan. Alan, go ahead, buddy.
Opie, Jimmy, fellas in the studio. Hey.
Ron's on for the first time. Funches, right?
Yep.
Okay, Ron Funches for the first time in studio playing Caroline's this weekend.
Caroline's, come on down. Hear all my jokes. Nothing to do with this.
We put you in a spot. I love it. Go ahead, Alan.
Coming from an old hippie, it used to be long hairs and black people. And now it's just black people. So I think we're making real good strides, gentlemen.
Well, the hippies just realized they cut their hair and they're good. Yeah. And they're good.
Yeah, black people can't cut their black.
But yeah, there was a lot of stories that came out of the 60s, early 70s especially, where hippies were getting, harassed by the cops.
Rousted.
Yeah. I mean, it goes for that.
Way back, Irish, I mean, it's not a new story. That's my whole thing. It just switches up. It's like you couldn't be Irish and walk around here.
Can't you support both sides, Black Lives Matter to a point, and the cops?
Yeah, what do you mean?
America's picking sides. They're like, it's either one or the, you know.
People are extremists, but you can care about Black Lives Matter and then hold cops to higher standards.
Do you think that's the majority, though, in the country?
I think it is, absolutely.
All right, that gives me hope.
Moderation
for
is
America.
The key. I've been saying that for years.
Unfortunately, social media, it's the majority is the other way. You got to pick a fucking
side. Who are the people who are really tweeting at you guys, you know? They're probably the most, it's like an egg avatar,
right?
Who's like, you know, look who the source is.
Yeah, Muppets. Bunch of stay-at-home Muppets. Dude,
I'm not even talking about our little world. I mean, just in general, that's what you see on Twitter. Nah. You got to pick a side. What side are you on?
I think your Twitter's weird, man.
You see it the other way?
In general, I think it's most people going, man, it sucks that people keep getting shot. Most people want to go back and look at this as a gun control issue more than anything. I feel is great. Like, how about that? If we had stricter gun control laws, then maybe that cop is like, I'm not even worried about getting shot because that dude can't have a gun. And then maybe that cop doesn't have a gun.
What about
maybe
the illegal guns? There's so many illegal guns in this country.
Yeah, you got to give a cop. Cops have to. You can't just give them tasers.
You can't. I mean, go to Italy. Go to other countries.
Give them lasso.
Everyone's dead from mafia vendettas in Italy.
Italy's a bad example. I saw a dude get arrested, no handcuffs, no guns. They tapped him on the shoulder, and he was like, oh, I'm done, I guess. And they took him away, and they had the little plastic things. That's it.
That'll happen. Most people would actually just go. Like, most of us would be reasonable.
Yeah. Yes,
but they don't carry guns for most of us.
I don't know, man. I'm at comedy clubs, and people don't. The tap on the shoulder does not work.
No. You ever see a bachelor party trying to get thrown out?
Oh, yeah. No, you're going to have to shoot a drunk white lady. I am saying. There ain't no reasoning with her. You gonna have to shoot her.
Alright, let's go to this guy. We're going to Texas. It looks like Thomas. Go ahead, Thomas.
Good morning. You know, we're still not having an honest conversation about this because everybody wants to just gloss over the fact that there are more problems in the African American community than there are in other communities.
This guy sounds like a source from his voice. You sound like a deep source into the African-American community.
Well, you don't have to ask anybody's opinion. It's statistics. They're facts. I mean, how can you deny that the broken families in the African-American community have affected the crime rates and high school dropouts and everything else? And I'm not saying I think that's a good thing. I think it's horrible. But to not talk about that and just put it all on the police is not having an honest conversation.
Broken families is not strictly an African-American problem. I mean, my dad left them from Manhattan. So, I mean, you know, it happens to a lot of people.
And I think a correlation between broken families and people committing light crimes, maybe drug crimes and things of that nature, are way different than being shot at a traffic stop. So I don't get your point.
No, well, the point is anybody engaged in crime has a higher likelihood to be engaged with the police. Is it right for the police to shoot somebody for a minor violation? Of course not. But any time you're engaged with the police, you run a higher risk of being hurt or injured just because the stakes are so high on both sides. Police don't know your intentions. They have no idea whether
But why should the stakes be that high in a traffic stop?
And why should police who are there to protect and serve, why shouldn't they assume intentions that they need to protect and serve this person as well?
The reason the stakes are so high is because for every one of those videos you see, which are heartbreaking, frankly, where somebody gets shot by the police, there's another video where some poor schmuck of a police officer walks up on the interstate to some guy, and the guy whips out a gun and kills him. Those are the videos that they show the police in their training, and I think it scares the hell out of them. And if I were in their position, I'd be scared, too, because you just don't know what their intention is.
I've seen a lot of those videos. I've seen a lot of those where cops walk up and literally just get, or a guy is, yeah. A guy is worried about, he's got a warrant, you know, or he's a felon and he has a gun. Like, there's a lot of guys that are just scared of going back to jail, or they know that if I get, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, cops get fucking shot at all the time.
That's a fair point.
Can you imagine you pull a car over and now you got to walk up to that car? How scary that would be?
It's scary. But, you know, it's I don't mean to say this in a cold way. It's part of what you signed up for.
Yeah, it's your job. Also, like, let's give them more money, more training.
Exactly.
I agree. I feel like that's my whole thing. You keep shooting black people, I want to give you more money. I want to give you more money, more training to require you more education. Because I feel like that's a big issue. Because you see the cops, a lot of the cops were my friends in high school, and those dudes were dumb as fuck.
Yeah, same.
Yeah, make them want to do the job, and, you know.
But how does that, let me ask this, and education is not wrong, but how does that stop a guy who's genuinely behaving violently? Like, you know what I mean? Some of the cops are reacting out of being afraid. I don't know how you fix somebody who's being afraid. I think you were right before when you said they put too many young guys in like white suburban guys in black neighborhoods, and they're scared to be there.
That's
or young Asian guy, and they're frightened to be there.
Right.
And I asked a friend of mine who's a lieutenant. I'm like, well, how come they don't have guys who grew up in the neighborhood who understand the dynamics, who aren't going to be afraid?
Absolutely.
And he said to me, could we do that? And they sue.
Right.
What happens is you take a guy from Bedford-Stuyvesant and you keep him in Bedford-Stuyvesant because he's not going to react afraid, because he's not intimidated by certain...
He's been around that his whole life.
He understands people, he understands his neighbors, but... He goes, what happens is these guys take us to court and go, how come that fucking white cop gets the cushy job in Greenwich Village while I'm stuck here? So I asked him that, and he goes, that's been tried.
Right.
But then the black cops
said, so they would take more pride in their community. They would care more about the job, you know?
I mean, that was just what he told me. It's not like it's just this irrational cops running amok thing. I think part of it, that was a good point about it, a lot of young guys don't know how to react in these situations.
Well, it's a very strange job, because the more experience you got, they move you out of the tougher neighborhoods and make your job a lot easier. We all know cops,
like,
and their first job is they go into the worst neighborhoods, and then guys earn their way out of those and get you know, maybe a place that's not as bad, and we all know that. But how do you change that?
I really don't know.
You can't have like a 20-year veteran and you know he's got all the experience in the world, but you know you send him to the horrible neighborhood still.
Yeah, because he'll probably know when to get out of the car and when not to. You know, half the time he'll be like, "Yeah, I don't want to do the paperwork."
We figured it out.
All right, thank you, sir. Let me go to good old Chuck in North Carolina, Chuck.
Hey, it's the grumpiest, the same old fucking shit over and over. That guy that you got on there, the black guy, was talking about, you don't hear about white people getting done like this. It's 'cause that ain't the fucking news. black people get shot and shit all kinds of times, but that don't make it on the fucking news and everybody gets stirred up about it. It happens all over the place. First of all, I don't know for sure if this is true, but that fucker in Minnesota that had the taillight out and all that shit had fucking $3,000 rims on his fucking car and couldn't fix his goddamn taillight. He never got pulled over. He fixed his goddamn taillight.
Yeah, that's really that's kind of victim blaming.
Sound like this, I feel.
Yeah,
like.
That's probably not the point because he had good rims on his car and a taillight being out. How do you know it didn't just happen?
True, it could have been. Nobody talks about that. Didn't have a violation on his car, he wouldn't have got pulled over.
Well, no, but a guy getting unjustifiably shot at a traffic stop, it's kind of hard to go, well, technically his taillight was out.
That guy that called in about the hoax, haven't they already got that girl in a couple of different things she said that was wrong? She said one thing, next time she says another. I don't smell right either. I don't think you should have got fucking shot. But you don't put yourself in a goddamn position to be fucking shot like that.
Well, then you should hold on. That's not fair, because no one is saying that about the Dallas cops. No one is saying they put themselves in a position to be shot by showing up. We're saying it was terrible that they were shot. So come on, man. That's not a right way to look at it.
I don't know a whole lot about the Dallas stuff. I really don't.
It's the biggest news story.
Well, they were shot by a guy, ex-military guy,
you're talking about the cops getting shot. Oh, yeah. That's huge. That ain't right. I don't give a damn how you look at it.
Well, no, Chuck.
I like that he said, I don't give a damn how you look at it, like it was a ballsy take to say it wasn't right that they were shot.
Yeah,
but
Chuck,
he got a lot of takes on the other shooter.
Yeah, Chuck, that's the point I'm making, is that you can't say, like, oh, don't put yourself in a position to get shot, and then these poor cops are shot, and no one is saying they put themselves in a position to be shot. Do you know what I mean? By getting pulled over, especially if you announce that you're a legal gun, you have a license, and you tell the cop, it's like, come on, man, you got to, cops overreact sometimes because they're afraid. That cop didn't seem racist to me. He seemed like he was afraid and freaked out, but he was still scared.
Yeah.
And I think he probably
more scared
reacted
than anything
wrong.
Is my take on that. And Chuck,
you can't justify that.
I heard, I don't know, a lot of people want to say that more white people are shot by cops. I mean, it's a numbers game. Sure, there's more white people in America than black people, but
sorry.
I mean, I would assume that's a real stat just by the numbers.
Yeah.
I would think so. There's just more white people than there are blacks. But let me tell you something happened in my town a week ago. A black guy in a project with three or four people in his car pulls a rifle out and starts shooting. They call the law. They chase him all over fucking town. He goes to another project on the other side of town. A girl gets out of the car and runs. He gets out with a rifle, points it at the cop, and he blows him a fucking way, okay? The goddamn black people in the town are going fucking nuts. He shouldn't have been killed, blah, 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 blah. Have you heard anything about that on the major news? Fuck no, because he was dead fucking wrong. They don't report that shit.
Well, the media is despicable.
Yeah, the media does a lot to cause a lot of racism, I think, as well.
You're exactly right. The media is a fuck-up.
But you can't, but when you look at it, Chuck, when you look at, like, the guy with the taillight, and you go, he shouldn't have had a taillight out. I mean, come on. That's just, we all have problems with our car. I mean, you know, you can't say, look, man, you have a problem with your car. You're risking being killed.
Well, like that guy said a while ago, just damn do what the cop says. I got put in jail 2 days ago. I didn't resist. I knew I was in trouble.
What do you do?
Are you black or white?
I'm white as fucking snow.
Chuck's a regular.
Did you do? Did you hold the people down like in Deliverance? Because that's what you sound like.
Yeah, what did you do, Chuck? What did you do?
We were having a party at my house, and this my daughter's husband pushed her down and hit her head on the side of a fucking on our deck. And he got up and wanted to run his mouth to her, and I beat the fuck out of him with a croquet mallet.
You play croquet?
My grandkids play croquet, and there was run right there, and I'm too old to fight with that young motherfucker, so I just beat the dog shit out of him till he bled like a fucking stuck pig. Jeez. And then he got up, run his mouth, and then he called the law on me. He fucking asked for it, and then he called the law on me.
Well, hold on. How come you didn't look at it like by she put herself in a position to...
She did. To he be- was drunk.
Oh, okay.
Fair enough. Weren't you ready? You were, weren't you worried that you were going to beat him to death?
No, I beat him till he started crying and blood was flying out, and I kicked him in the ribs two or three times. I bet he don't fucking do it again.
Will you guys make up? Will you guys make up?
Make up? No, he'll never be. If she takes that motherfucker back, I'll ride her out of my fucking wheel anyway.
Wow. Oh, she's going to miss out.
She's not going to get the recipes, huh?
I'll beat the fuck out of anybody that touches my wife or my family. I ain't waiting on the fucking law to go to court there. I bet he don't do it again. I bet you that.
What were his injuries? Did you ever find out?
Yeah.
I don't know. He got some stitches in his ribs. It's hurt. He'll probably take me to court and try to soak some money out of me. I don't give a fuck. He learned his fucking lesson.
Yeah, Chuck does well for himself. Yeah. He's got money this time.
Chuck, you need a podcast.
He sells cocaine mallets.
Yeah, he's got cocaine. No, my kids, they do the polo.
Ron, just so you know, this guy used to be in the Christmas tree business.
No, really? Yeah. That's
which makes business. This story even better.
You got them duck furs? You a duck fur man?
Christmas trees made me a lot of money.
Amen.
Whoa, all kidding aside there.
Yeah, relax, man. Got all serious on us. Chuck.
I like Chuck.
Life is good.
All right, Chuck. Thank you, buddy.
How are the gays?
All right, man.
The gays are still moving in?
Oh, motherfuck, man. Them motherfuckers, man, if you want to see some fags and lesbians, you come to fucking Asheville, North Carolina.
That's
you
what I always did.
You're in Asheville? That's like the liberal part of North Carolina.
No, he's actually just reading the sign.
it didn't used to be that way, man. I'll tell you what they've done. They come in there and they all want to hold hands and sing fucking Kumbaya. And what brought them to Asheville, all the nice trees and the greenery.
Well, so you're responsible. People. You're the one selling the nice trees.
Right. Yeah, you had a whole mountainside of green trees.
Well, I've been there. It's a liberal town.
I don't live down there in the town. I live back.
Or not go
country,
with the joke. Whatever. Great. That's fine too.
Well, gay people are gay people are great neighbors. They're not a problem.
Yeah, they clean up everything.
How can you
not
like gay people moving in or lesbians? What do they do?
Right.
Well, they just fucking fuck the damn town up, man.
How?
Everybody's got to conform to what they want.
Which is what?
They're not the...
You don't sound like you're conforming.
Fucking, yeah, Chuck, what do they want? That's so
unreasonable. You're staying strong, Chuck.
Yeah, they clean up the neighborhood, make it look nice, smell nice.
Yeah. We ran out of grooms, putting both of them on a cake. Chuck, what else do they
every
want?
Every once in a while, you guys see two grown men kissing. You're all right with that, right?
You know when they damn shot them people down there in Orlando? Is that where it was? That fag club?
Yeah.
they had a goddamn. They got the oldest gay club in North Carolina in Asheville, and they had this big fucking thousands of people up there holding fucking hands of queers and flip flops and earrings and goddamn. It's fucking sickening. And then they worried about security. If you're worried about getting shot right after a bunch of queers got shot.
Oh, my God.
Chuck, you're a fucking ignorant dope.
Yeah, that's
really.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah, that, you really can't are. Let that go. That's just ridiculous.
You really are stupid.
Jesus.
Because no, not that you have to like. The whole, I don't care. It's not realistic.
The whole community was mourning.
If you're worried about that happening again, why fucking the very next 2 days draw a crowd of 2,000 people in a town full of fucking rednecks?
Well, then you remember that. Hold on. Remember that the next time that there's some other kind of crime then. You got to think that with terrorism or any other kind of crime. So you're basically saying, hey, man, you know they're going to shoot you. What are you doing coming out? Yeah. So I guess that's the way it should be with terrorism. We shouldn't react to it. We shouldn't fight it. We should just go, hey, man, don't go out because you know they're going to try to kill you.
And I don't think they were being naive. I think they were being brave, standing up to it. Like, look, you're not going to scare us. We believe in what's going on in our community.
Yeah.
And we're going to continue to fight the good fight.
What kind of shitty American considers himself a patriot and doesn't want to protect citizens like that? Like, what kind of fucking lousy American thinks you're being patriotic or a good countryman and you don't want to fucking see people like that protected?
Yeah.
I didn't say they shouldn't be protected. I said, don't fucking cry and complain about when you draw 2,000 people holding fucking cameras in a town full of mountain people that can't stand fucking queers.
Well, the mountain people don't have to like queers.
You got to diversify your middle portfolio,
bro. The mountain people don't have to like queers. How about they just behave and do what the fucking law says? And their personal feelings... Their personal feelings.
They didn't do a thing. Mountain people didn't do a thing to those people.
Okay, then why should they be uncomfortable going around mountain people?
Well, the point of it is, why get on the goddamn TV camera and say all the mountain people's going to kill you because you congregated together when they didn't do a fucking thing to them?
I don't think
they just wanted fucking attention. That's all it was. They wanted attention, and they got it.
Well, you're giving it to them.
Wow, we got to tear down these mountains.
Fuck them. I wouldn't piss on a group full of queers if it's on fire. Fuck them. They're all going to hell anyway.
That's just silly, Chuck. Your daughter got into a healthy heterosexual relationship. Look what happened.
Yeah.
But, you know what I mean? Come on. That's silly.
Yeah, I'm a Christian, man. Those people aren't going to hell.
Look what just happened in your house. Look what just happened in your house.
Wait a minute. Did that guy say he was a Christian and he thinks homosexuals aren't going to hell?
Yeah, Theo Von, who knows? Yeah, he's a bit religious.
Yeah, man.
What kind of religion is he?
Just straight up old-fashioned Christian, bro. I know the way.
Okay. And so you read the Bible? You know that?
I mean, I haven't read the whole thing, no.
Well, you need to look into it because gays and lesbians ain't going nothing but hell.
You should be fighting the good fight, buddy. I mean, instead of sitting here talking safely on the phone, you should be over there fighting the good fight because Islam and Christianity are fucking duking it out.
Fuck a bunch of them damn raghead motherfuckers.
Okay. That's easy to say.
We're just going to keep moving
That's
around.
Easy to say, but, you know, I mean, if you believe that strongly, then you should be doing something more with that belief.
One person, listen, the toothpaste is out of the fucking tube. We're on the downside hillside of this country and this world.
We've been saying that do you understand, Chuck, every generation says that? Every generation. They've been saying it since the Vikings. Oh, hell in a handbasket. We're not. We're not going down the tubes. We're not. America used to be fucking terrific and now it stinks. Stop it. It's silly. Every generation says that.
If you've gone to church and you've read the Bible, all that shit that's happening over there where all that oil is and all that shit's going on has been in the Bible, and it talks about when all that shit starts and when the damn men are with men, all that Sodom and Gomorrah shit.
Wait, it says
eventually
that?
Eventually it's coming true.
Well, were you thinking of the scriptures when you picked up the croquet mallet?
Eye for eye, tooth for tooth.
That's what I say.
Yeah, that's true. It's in there, the eye for an eye thing. You're right.
A damn guy pushes your daughter down, your daughter's husband pushes her down drunk.
I have no problem.
Yeah, that's like the only thing about you that I've found to be decent is that you defended your daughter. Other than that,
he's a family man.
If you're asking me, I have no problem with what you did to your daughter's boyfriend.
Well, I think the point would be that she should have been raised better not to marry a guy like that. So
that's
I would say
true
the fault
too.
Is.
I told her not to marry that sorry motherfucker anyway.
Well, I think that you should have been a good Christian and practice what you preached and not let them into your home then if she married someone that you didn't like and who was bad for the family.
Well, if I damn shun my daughter's husband off, I'd never see her.
Okay.
You can't, if you try, like I talk when your daughter's dating a worthless cocksucker, you try to talk to her and everything, but when they're young, the more you go against the motherfucker, the more they go to him 9 times out of 10.
He's not wrong. As a parent, you do learn, even if you raise your kids what you think is right, they could still be fuck-ups. That's the scary part about it, being a parent. There's no guarantee in the end.
Yeah, that's exactly right. You do what you can do and hope for the fucking best, because you can't be with them 24 hours a day.
All right.
Well,
wise words.
He's got some strong opinions, this guy.
He does.
Here's what I'm fixing to do. I got me a brand new tractor with air conditioning. I'm going to ride up on top of the hill and smoke me a joint. Listen to the rest of the show.
All right, Chuck.
Chuck in North Carolina.
Bye, man.
Let's hang out, Chuck. I'll come to Asheville.
Ron Funches. So you picked a hell of a day to make your first appearance.
No, I'm happy. This is what I wanted. All right.
What else is on your mind?
What else is on your mind?
You started this.
You started trashing the Jews.
The Holocaust. Let's get into that. You're playing Caroline's this weekend.
Yeah, I'm Caroline's tonight through Saturday. Just doing some shows and trying to get better at comedy. Come on down and watch that. That was a great pitch.
You want to take any more of these calls? I mean, they are lit, but we've pretty much done most of this. Thinks people are missing the point. Cops shouldn't be using excessive force. We talked about that. Mark in Milwaukee thinks it's ridiculous that white people think cop shootings would stop if they stopped resisting. It's BS. Kind of talked about that, didn't we?
Yeah.
Some of the shootings would stop. All of them wouldn't. Some right. would. There are times where guys just get fucking angry because they've been dealing with cops in an unpleasant way. And they react. Like, you know, again, I watched Keith react that night because he was going by all those past experiences. So, yeah.
You know what was an eye-opener? Do you guys watch Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee? And it was Chris Rock and Jerry Seinfeld. And they're speeding on, I think it was the New Jersey Turnpike. And they got pulled over. And Jerry thought it'd be, you know, this is hilarious. And you could see Chris Rock trying to still be in the moment of what the show's all about. But you could see it. In his essence, like, dude, seriously, let's fucking play this right.
Yeah, there's not a bit anymore.
What no, the fuck did Sammy Steele just go? Could,
huh?
Oh, okay.
He couldn't hold it. Yeah, we've been on the air a long time. But it was subtle, but you could see Chris's whole demeanor was changing in that moment. Like,
Yeah, I mean, it's just ingrained. We don't really play around with that type of stuff because you don't. I mean, that's the thing that gets weird because you're like, oh, I work so hard and I do all the things right and I work my ass off. And then you're like, oh, the wrong dude just goes, oh, no, you're just a fucking, you know, piece of shit. You right. know, and that's what I think of you. That's what I see when I see you, you know, it kind of humbles you and changes, reminds you of your status in this country.
All right. Why don't we take a break? We'll come back, wrap up, get plugs in and all that, because I got a leak now, too.
I have to piss desperately.
I'm good to go. Let's do another 3 hours, guys.
Hey, we'll just, I'm out of here, but you can fucking.
Okay, I'll just
stay. We'll keep this thing on. We'll keep this thing on for you.
My show. Racist people, call me up.
You stepped into a bear trap today. And you got to meet Chuck, one of our regulars. Yeah, doesn't mean we agree with his opinions. I want you to understand that.
No, you guys seem pretty well measured. You go back and forth. It's weird because I would like you guys talk to a bunch of people who I just go, I would never even talk to you. So it's kind of cool to sit here and listen to that and listen to these people and go, oh, these are real human beings.
I like to hear where someone's head's at.
Yeah.
It's interesting on that level, but I don't know. Jimmy, what do you got?
Just Columbus next Thursday, the Capitol Theater, and then that Thornville, Ohio date with the Juggalos, and then September 15th and 16th is Minneapolis and Pittsburgh. Those dates have been moved, so they're still on sale on the website, and the new UFC podcast is out today.
Right.
Matt, Sarah, and myself.
Very nice. All right. Ron Funches at Caroline's tonight through
Ron
Saturday.
Ron is very funny, and you know him from At Midnight. He's made a shitload of appearances, and I think the winningest guy on there.
Yeah, I am. Really well. I'm really good at At Midnight. I was in a show called Undateable. I was in a movie called Get Hard. I'm really good at comedy. You should come check it out if you're interested in it. Come on by. I just mostly talk about video games and weed and my son and shit. It's a good time.
How old is your son?
He's 13 now.
You're a 13-year-old son?
Yeah, I do.
So let's talk Pokemon Go after the break. We're just going to wrap up properly.
Yes.
These guys were peeing. Ron, it was really nice to meet you. I've heard great things about you.
Thank you. I just glad to be here on this show. I mean, it's something I always listened to when I was younger, and which makes you seem old.
You don't have to say seem anymore.
But yeah. It's just good to be here, and I had a good time.
Yeah, you come back. Ron Funches is at Caroline's tonight through Saturday. I was kidding, but you're not playing the Pokemon Go.
I try to, but I don't like it, and it's not for the same reason. Everybody else is like, oh, it's making everybody nerds. I'm just like, I don't want to play a video game that makes me go outside. That's not what games are about. I want to go inside. That's why I like virtual reality. I want to go deeper inside. I want to pretend to be outside while being inside.
Well, one of the reasons the game is so popular because everyone's happy that people are finally getting outside again. Now E-Rock taught us about a cheat. You put the game on a turntable and then the
ceiling fan.
Or a ceiling fan, and then it's like you are outside. You're putting in the time of walking around.
I'm not into it. I need a PlayStation. I need like a 50-inch screen, and I need to be murdering people.
What's your favorite game?
Uncharted series. That's my favorite.
Yeah, it's cool.
See these guys.
I don't know any of them. I stopped playing video games years ago. I'm too addicted. I tried GTA because we were in it, and I just kept backing into the fucking fence. And I'm like, enough. I literally could not get the car out of the fucking parking lot.
You couldn't get the car going.
Oh, it was terrible. I was like fucking Vanity before she got shot in 52 pickup. Good
that
reference.
That was for GTA 4 when Laszlo came in with GTA 5. Norton figured out how to get behind a motel and landed in the pool.
Yeah.
And he couldn't get the car out of the pool.
That's right.
I do like NBA 2K, like the only game I play, but then I just like end up doing the season. I don't even play the game. I just like make trades and shit.
Oh, really?
I just, like, make the, I just make the Knicks relevant, and then I don't even play the games, you know?
Did that get good? I used to love
the game's amazing.
I used to love the basketball video games, but they didn't have it right when I was playing. I mean, I'm dating myself. It was tough to fucking maneuver those guys. It was very clunky to gameplay.
Yeah, like NBA Live.
Probably.
Yeah.
I'm talking way too many years ago.
Early 90s, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I'm like Jimmy. I get too obsessive with that shit, so I know too. I can't with two kids and wife and
that's
a radio
exactly
job.
When you
I
should.
Can't do it. No.
Yeah, you can't lose your career and family.
Yeah, sounds like
to that.
You got a lot to escape from.
No, I can't.
Well, he is doing the Pokemon Go, so he's got to walk around.
I'm fooling around with it. Just a little bit, Ron. Don't judge.
I'm not judging.
I put it on my phone for my kid. And now I come home every day like, look what I got for you. And then he looks at it for like 30 seconds and he's like, yeah, whatever. And then he goes back to his Minecraft.
Yeah, exactly.
He's all about Minecraft.
Yeah, Minecraft's like, awesome.
It's pretty. That's a pretty sweet game. I like watching him do that. It's fucked up how these little kids know their way around an iPad and the computer. It scares me.
Yeah, my son started deleting his internet history.
Oh, that's gangster.
Oh,
that's
really?
Hilarious. I'm like, you know, porn is the best case scenario in that regard, you know? He could be trying to build bombs for all I know.
But you know he's finally deleting his history.
Mm-hmm. I do know that.
That's like the two signs, deleting the history and once they want a lock on their door. That's how you know shit's going down, right?
Does he have the lock on the door?
No lock on the door yet. He's like, come on in. I got no shame.
All right. Well, Ron's going to be at Caroline's. I highly recommend you check him out if you're local. Especially if you've never seen Ron, you're not going to be disappointed. Tonight through Thursday, 212-757-4100, I believe, for tickets.
Sure, for phone numbers, who knows?
I believe that's the number for Caroline's if you want to get your seats now.
Go get them.
What happened? Oh, tonight through Saturday. Thursday,
yeah,
Friday.
I mean, today is Thursday. I think people got it.
Tonight through Saturday.
Yeah.
I might have said Sunday in there.
Okay, yeah.
All right. Theo, it was a pleasure seeing you.
Yeah, man. Great to see you guys. Thank you for the time, man.
And you're a fucking champ for coming in after only sleeping 2 hours.
I need a nap, man.
Tequila shots and a haircut from a stranger.
Hugo,
right. We know his name now.
Yeah.
With the one bad eye.
I'm going to get some more information about him.
He said his equipment was old, too, Ron. He wanted a haircut. He usually cuts his own hair.
Do you have clippers?
He's kind of seemed like a sharecropper a little bit.
See, he believes in cutting his own hair. So this is strange that nice then he went and decided to find someone else to cut his hair.
I just felt I opened up a little bit. I saw, what's his name, his bangs, and I was like, I'm going to try something different.
You got bang jealous.
Yeah.
He was bothered by Florentine's bangs. No one would think Florentine has bangs, but fucking Theo thought he had bangs.
They're nice.
What, Eric?
So I get this email from Mark Norman.
Yeah.
So apparently he's having a problem with a video that is openly that Mark Norman has chlamydia. And he said 6 different girls he's been with in the past have reached out to him angrily. He's
like, can
we change the title? And I had to tell him it's not our video.
Yeah, we didn't put up that video.
Nope.
Mark Norman admitted on our show that he has chlamydia. That's not my problem.
Yeah. He's in the Poon Hall of Fame already, I think.
Right.
His jersey's being pulled up to the rafters. He's
he's got them all.
But then Ari Shaffir told him, just, sit out for 10 days and you're good. And then we had to tell him that's not the truth. And we got a doctor on the phone, and then we actually got him all freaked out.
He said Dr. Steve helped him out yesterday, and he is now chlamydia free.
Ooh. He's not. He's still.
Mark.
He's not, though.
He talked him out of it. The doctor talked him out of it.
He's taking.
Out of Flintstones chewable.
He's taking a medication, but it doesn't kick in less than 24 hours.
Yeah.
He will be chlamydia free. I don't know. I would say this time next week. Let's be safe with this.
Yeah. So give him a week, ladies.
Make him earn it. Just go out on dates with him and just make him earn it for that week.
But Ari was the one that said, just sit out for 10 days and it goes away on its own. That's
don't fall for Mark's horseshit lines. I feel something here.
Yeah.
I like you.
You've seen
And then the next time the girl goes up, like, Mark goes, you're crazy.
Really?
It's a 180.
That's hilarious.
I shouldn't be giving away his tricks here, but.
Well, if he's going to admit he has chlamydia.
Mark is the best pickup line. His opener is, he goes, if I weren't gay. That's his pickup line, and it works every time.
Because it's a challenge to the lady, right?
Well, because they're like, he's funny.
Yeah.
And then it's, you know.
Right. Theo?
I'm straight.
Oh, is this about? Oh, yeah.
The plugs.
Oh, yeah, the plugs. Yeah, I'm going to be in.
You weren't being accused.
Okay. I'm in Naples, Florida at Off the Hook, August 4th through 7th. And I'm here in New York, September 2nd and 3rd at Gotham Comedy Club.
Is that the next time we're going to see you? September, probably?
I'll see you in August.
Oh, good. Yeah, come on by, man. Open fucking door for you guys.
I appreciate it, man. I'm going to get some rest.
All right, yeah. Go. At least you didn't puke like Caitlin Farrington did yesterday.
I considered. I heard about that. Right in front of Paul Feig.
It was a gold medalist puking in front of the director of Ghostbusters. That's why this job fucking rules. Where else do you get to see that shit? And then Jimmy itching his ass during the whole thing.
No, it's beautiful. Back with the back of his hand.
Yeah, he dug in. He needed to fucking itch his ass crack. And Sam Morrell, what do you got, buddy?
Comedy Attic in Bloomington, Indiana, tonight through Saturday. Tuesday, Green Mountain Comedy Fest in Vermont. And then that 22nd through 23rd of July, I'll be DC Draft House, and if you're in Montreal, roast battling Steve Ranazzisi. So that'll be interesting.
Wow.
Oh, and last one, sorry, Orlando Space Bar, August 24th. That's a door deal, so please come out to that. I need you, Orlando.
Of all of them, come to that one. That's when you guys make the most money.
Just fly to Orlando. Just fly to Orlando. And then I'm at Side Splitters that weekend in August in Tampa. But come to that show, even if you live in Tampa.
All right. We're out. Podcast, Eric. What do we got? We got
Willie Walker Jr.
And his dirty songs, his dirty country songs.
His last appearance, performing a couple live songs from his new album. And also, we take a look back at the first couple of clips of 8-Track Porn.
Jesus. Wow. That's from the archives, man. That's way back.
Right.
And we got great videos on the YouTube channel right now with Caitlin Farrington puking. Most have seen it by now, I guess. We'll tweet it out again, or we probably have. It's a great video. Most of the videos are like, whatever. If you're into the guest, fine. But every once in a while, we get a really good one, and that one's really good. Yeah, right in front of fucking Paul Feig.
Yep.
From Ghostbusters. All right, we're out of here. Thank you.